guys, appreciate all of you being here again tonight. We have a little bit different stuff we're doing today with both here. I know both presented at some of these that we've done before, but what we have, and Bo, by the way, has been our strength and conditioning coach for Mount Lacrosse since we won varsity 4 years ago. Huge, huge part of our program, and a huge part of developing lacrosse athletes, this strength and conditioning, speed training, all of those things that we do. And one of the questions we get a lot, the way the recruiting's going for us now, recruiting all ages of high school kids, a lot of kids we have in the 14, 15 years old, and one of the questions we get a lot of the time is, what should we be doing at this age to get ready? And so, thought this would be a great opportunity for Bo to present some of his thoughts on what you guys can be focused on at any age, youth players through high school players, getting ready for college and helping them perform the best they can at whatever level you're coaching right now. So, Bo. By the way, we gave Bo a half hour tonight. This is, Bo's probably in a lot of pain right now. Because Bo would want to talk about this stuff for like 7 hours. So we'll see what happens. But you have a half hour. Lots on, Bo. Go.
Where's my first 20 seconds on the sip of coffee? Again, thanks a ton for you guys coming out. Hopefully we can give you some ideas you can take back with you and be able to utilize in your programs and surrounding programs. Sure, yeah, absolutely. The big question was, you know, where do we start with introduction of strength and conditioning programs, or how do we do that with adolescent and youth athletes? And this is a common question across the spectrum of competition, whether it be lacrosse, volleyball, basketball, football, baseball, especially in the United States. As we formalized strength training programs for youth, are few and far between unless you get into a private club. Or a private strength and conditioning facility or something along those lines. So I do have 18 slides, which Coach asked me to stay within 30 minutes, so I'm going to cut through a lot of those slides. But the big thing that I want you guys to take away from it is that there's a concept out there right now amongst in the field of strength and conditioning known as long-term athletic development. And the National Strength and Conditioning Association actually has a number of papers and position statements on long-term athletic development. There's one in particular that I want to point out. I'll come back to these slides. It's a practical application of long-term athletic development by a guy named Larry Metters. Larry Metters is about a 50-year strength and conditioning coach. He's a high school educator, high school athletics coach. He's coached track and field in a number of different sports. He's put a lot of time and effort into accumulating a lot of research and information on athletic development in youth, both male and female. I put a link on there so you can go and you can pull that up. That's a great resource, mainly because it's there's a lot of research out there on the topic, and some of it gets a little bit extensive in terms of the terminology. You got to have a PhD in exercise physiology to understand half of it. He does a really good job of breaking it down into layman's terms and making it a little bit more practical for high school and junior high coaches to understand and implement into their programs. So, just something to go back to. A lot of the information I have in these slides came directly from Larry's research and a lot of his input on the topic. So backing up here, where do we start? Long-term athletic development, talent development. There's a lot of opinions and a lot of research on it. But you're looking at anywhere from 8 to 14 years specialized in a particular skill to become elite. Now there's a range there because you have talent acquisition. You have some kids with a God-given talent for a particular skill, and then other skill that's actually developed. But you're looking anywhere 18 to 14 years. So if the kid starts when he's 8, by the time he's 16 to 18 years old, you can probably see some pretty refined skill, some things he doesn't have to quite focus on to be able to just make happen. So that's the time frame you're looking at. Another big part of talent development is your strength and your conditioning development and programming throughout that chunk. Your stronger athlete, your athlete that's more fit, is going to be able to reproduce consistent and accurate skills throughout that developmental time period. Your weaker athlete is going to be a little bit tougher for them to repeat those efforts. They're going to fall under fatigue a little bit faster. So your stronger, fitter athlete is going to be able to reproduce the skill that you're looking for, refine more often. So that's why there's an importance on, you want your kids to be more fit. You want your kids to be to be stronger. There are a lot of other side effects from being strong a bit, like staying healthy and just flat out outrunning the other team or running over the other team. That's always fun to see. But ultimately, we want them to be able to reproduce effective skills. Another big part of where do we start? Coaches' education. So I've coached on in the NAIA level. I've done a little bit in high school and strength and conditioning. And usually how it happens is we got to get somebody in the weight room. Oh, there, Jimmy. Jimmy, you're going to go and you're going to work with the kids in the weight room. When we get done with practice or when we get done with PE, you're going to go and you're going to take those kids and you're going to put them through a strength program. Whoever that person is, however they get selected or identified, that's going to handle those responsibilities for your program, just make sure, just like if they were going to undertake, being an offensive coordinator or a defensive coordinator, make sure they understand the responsibility there. What are we trying to gain from it? What do I need to know? There's a heavy liability when it comes to strength training or conditioning athletes far beyond what we normally think we're undertaking. But you want to make sure that there's a certain level of coaching education there. Provide them with some resources. Let them be able to get their hands on some books. Let them be able to get out and get in front of some clinics and things like this so that they can be prepared and provide your athletes with suitable means to strength train and to condition so that they're developing appropriately. Fundamental movement skills is a big part. Everyone wants to get fancy right off the get-go. They see a player online doing a skill that looks really fun and looks really advanced, and they want to get the second year player that's 10 years old to try to replicate that with the same speed, same velocity. And for one, it's a little overzealous, but for two, there are a lot of other very fundamental things that kids should be learning in order to play safe and to play accurate and to play fast and to be able to repeat those efforts over and over again. And then the last thing we're going to hit on is formulating a plan. That's the toughest thing. I think that's the biggest thing I get in terms of questions from coaches is, okay, I got all this stuff. Good details, coach. That's a great drill. Thanks for that drill. How do I put it together and make a plan out of it? We realize that coaches, whether it be at the junior high level or up in Division I, they have a lot of other responsibilities and things to take care of, let alone sit down for a couple of hours a day and design a program for these guys for strength and conditioning. So with that, long-term athletic development model, if you refer to the link that I provided you later on, you only have to pull out laptops now, but if you'll take a look at that, you'll get a clear understanding of what they're talking about. And they cover a broad spectrum of sports, not just lacrosse. So it really applies to just about anything, not only skill development for sport, but also strength, power, speed, and agility development as well. Okay, so basically, if you look at that study, if you look at that article, one of the key features I think that Larry throws in there is the sequential formula for athletic development. He basically breaks it down into some very simple stages, from fundamental movement, which is basically jogging, skipping, your most fundamental things that a child should be able to learn how to do, although every year we get kids that come in, and I ask him to skip, and the kid doesn't know how to skip. Or I ask him to skip backwards, and he starts tripping over himself. Or I ask him to shuffle sideways, and he starts tripping over himself. So very fundamental movements. Then you get into more dynamic movements. Some of your fancier footwork with dodges and jukes and things to be able to move around, still balanced and controlled, accelerate and decelerate rapidly on demand with good balance and control. That gets more into your dynamic movement, your plyometric movement. And then on further down the spectrum is actually development of speed, strength, and ultimately power. Your most powerful athletes, they're the most recognizable. They're the ones that can execute high-level skills the fastest, and they can repeat those efforts more often than their competitors. So this is kind of the spectrum that you're looking at in terms of where to start with a young kid. I'm not sure if he should be lifting weights, or I'm not sure if we should be running that long and that hard. Start with basic dynamic movement first. Move forward once they get a handle on that into some more strength and eventually some power development. One thing with developing or where to start with the strength and conditioning program is look at the talent development as well. What does practice consist of? How simple are our practices? Are we working on heavily on fundamentals, or do I have a more advanced program, a more advanced team? Well, we're getting some more advanced skills. That can help you determine on where to start with your strength program or your conditioning program. If you've got a pretty low-level talent, group of athletes, it may be beneficial for you to revamp your program a little bit and start out a little simpler. So what does practice consist of? How long is practice? Where can I fit supplemental training in? Does it seem more appropriate when you look at the broad spectrum to fit your stuff in if you're going to lift weights or if you're going to condition pre-practice, post-practice? A lot of times with agility training and some of the endurance training, it's even more appropriate to fit it in within practice, within those minutes, so that you don't spread your athletes too thin by doing three or four different sessions within a day. So just some points to think about. Coaches education. So some things to think about with the coaching education piece is personnel. Identify who that person is going to be, or a group of individuals. Who are they going to be that are going to undertake the responsibilities of the strength and conditioning program within your staff? Qualifications, liability. You don't need to go out and get a whole bunch of certifications, but what you do need to be able to get a hold of is some literature, which is pretty easy these days with the internet. You can pretty much Google anything and find tons of literature. Speed development, throw it in there. You'll get a ton of articles in there. There really is no right or wrong information out there. The more experienced you become and you start digging through that information, is you're going to figure out some of it's a little more applicable for your group of athletes than maybe some of the other things that you read. So it's a matter of just sifting through information. The liability piece is important. If in the case somebody does happen to get banged up doing your program and they get hurt doing your program, you got to be able to show why you were doing it, how you were instructing it, where you got that information from, does it make sense, does it hold any water? Plus, you want to be able to continue implementing that program once that little event has passed on. You don't want this to put a halt in your program. Bumps and bruises do happen, so you just want to be able to protect yourself. A mission. You got to have a mission with your training. What are we trying to get out of this? What are our goals, short-term and long-term? We reset our training goals every year. Sometimes in our staff meetings, we're resetting goals weekly, depending on the individual or depending on the position group or depending on the classification of the athlete. Assessment. How are you determining whether or not your program's working? Are you measuring things? How frequently are you measuring things? Do you have standards or deadlines? You have to be able to do A by this point and B by this point. Those are the things you want to think about because they'll keep the validity in your program. They'll help keep your athletes accountable for it. One big thing that you'll take away from Larry Metter's paper, as well as something that I strongly believe in, is avoid early specialization. What that means is if you identify a four-year-old and say he's going to be a lacrosse player, that's it. He's not going to try anything else. That's what I mean by early specialization, and it happens from time to time. The problem with early specialization is you end up avoiding a lot of other fundamental movement skills that they could be picking up through other athletic events. For example, gymnastics, swimming, baseball. You can pick up skills from each of those that could contribute to a performance on a lacrosse field. So specialization, in terms of what should they be spending the majority of their time on, happens post-pubescent, most of the time around sophomore, junior year of high school. They can still be a multi-sport athlete up until that point. Even if they're highly talented in, say, a sport like lacrosse, and you know they're going to pursue that, they can gain some benefits from participating in some of these other athletic events. Avoid early specialization. Emphasize basic movement and skill development, which we're going to talk about more in just a second. So first area, fundamental movement skills. What's Bo talking about when he says fundamental movement skills? There's tiers of it, and the first tier is balance and stability. I don't necessarily mean balance and stability as in this, standing on one foot, because it doesn't really pertain to a player dodging around on the field and avoiding contact and being able to execute a shot. Balance and stability meaning when he gets into the position that his coach is asking him to get into, can he do it fast? Can he do it balanced? And when he's in that position, can he change directions or redirect in any direction that he may need to once he's in that position? So you as a coach, that's where you get to use your eyeballs and kind of use your God-given physics ability to understand, okay, that's a good position for him. Or maybe that's not a good position for him. You need him lower. You need his stance wider. You need his body weight more centered over his feet. Those are things you can identify both in practice and through training. But balance, the ability to stop and land is really critical. If you look at, say, a 6 or 7 year old that's picking up skills with a stick, he's learning how to use a stick and learning how to track the ball, hand-eye coordination. At the same time, he may not be a very good decelerator. He may not be very good at running up and then stopping all of a sudden, balanced and under control. he may not be strong enough to be able to stop and land, and someone's blowing by him to open his hips up and then track that guy down to get in a good defensive position again. To be able to twist and spin. These are critical for all kinds of different sports, but we take them for granted a lot because most of the time when kids are little, they learn how to do that by throwing a ball. Well, if you don't throw that ball, then you never pick that up. So then later on, when you try to rotate to swing a stick or you try to rotate to swing a golf club, it's not there. You kind of have to practice it at some point. To dodge and to fall, reacting if I need to move out of the way, or if I fall down, how to quickly get back up on my feet and control in a balanced state so that I can redirect and continue to play. In athletic positions, that just goes back to, where does my coach want me? Does he want me in a three-point stance? Does he want me standing up? Does he want me sumo? Does he, what is my body supposed to look like? And that's something that as coaches we have to constantly, even when they're 19, 20, 22 years old, we still have to reinforce those. Moving a little more advanced, our basic dynamic movement skills, running forwards, backwards, in angles. Think of this in terms of your youth kids. On demand, they may not be able to run in an angle. You'll say, run this way, they'll square their shoulders up and run directly that way. Or if you tell them, I want your shoulders to face this way, but I want you to run that way, it's a little weird to them. Those are things you have to develop. So, for example, if you got your 16-year-old player in high school who's having trouble opening up his hips and changing his angle, he could just have trouble with a really fundamental running mechanic of running on an angle. So you can go back and get into these really simple skills of running forward, running backwards, running in angles to address some of that. And you can identify who your stronger runners are and who's not. Skipping, forwards and backwards. This happens all the time. Division I lacrosse. All right, Johnny, come in. I want to see you skip. And you can't do it. It's a basic coordinated effort, and it translates into a ton of other speed-specific drills that we need to be able to do later on. Shuffling and sliding. Being able to shuffle your feet and keep distance, keep width. Meaning if I slide, if I'm defending this way and I slide and move, I want to keep a certain amount of distance and space between my feet. If my feet come together, I'm momentarily stuck. So if the person I'm defending takes off the other direction, I have to create space in my feet first, and then I have to move. Whereas if my base was spread out to begin with and I'm moving, I can open up and move immediately on reaction. So these are things that you can practice just in the basic skill development of a youth, of a child, sliding and shuffling. Hopping, jumping, both single leg and double leg. This is getting a little bit more into advanced athletics. It always looks cool when someone flies through the air or someone does a spin, leaves off of one foot. Those are always cool things to watch, but they're few and far between because a lot of those kids aren't learning those fundamentals when they're young, very young. And then the last area is object control. So kicking, rolling, throwing, or striking an object. Or catching, stopping, or trapping an object, and then dribbling with your hands, dribbling something with your feet, and of course cradling something with a stick. So these get into more advanced skills. So when I break these skills into these categories, I don't mean that Jimmy and Johnny can't practice catching, stopping, and trapping until they're 16, 17 years old. Just that the predominance of their training when they're, say, 6, 7, 8 years old should be more of those basic movement skills, and then you sprinkle in a little bit of this. As they move further down the categories and they start getting 16, 17, 18 years old, obviously they need to have that stick in their hand more often as they're getting more playing time. They're playing in more leagues, they're playing more frequently, and now they're spending more of the 52-week year actually playing lacrosse. So sure, that by that point, they need to have that stick in their hand more often. So you go from simple, as they're younger, simple, basic, fundamental, physical movement skills to very, what we call advanced, but specialized sports skills as they get older. Just want you to have an understanding of the spectrum of that. So intro into resistance training. So this would be really simple if I just walked in and said, all right, coach, here you go. Here's resistance. This is your strength program for your team. Go get them. That would be really easy. And I wish it was like that because we get calls all the time and say, coach, I really like what you're doing. Your kids look good. We want our team to emulate that. Can I have your program? And in all honesty, our program is developed to fit our system, to fit our scheme here. We have 50 athletes. Amongst the 50, I have about 7 different programs going on within the group of 50 at any given time. If I'm lucky, it'll be fewer than that. But what that means is I may have a group of kids, group of athletes on one particular program for a set of circumstances. And at the same time, another group of 6 or 7 athletes would be on an entirely different program due to a set of circumstances. So what I want to be able to give you some information where you can go and jot down a few things and construct some very simple ideas so that you have something you can implement with your own group if you feel that that's of importance to you. So develop fundamental movement skills first. What are you guys good at? What are they not good at? That's how you come up with fundamental movement skills. If you got a team full of a bunch of great runners, you may not have to do all that much running. If you got a team that's not very fit and you don't have very many good runners on there, you may have to beef up your running regimen and what you're doing in that area. Developmental movement skills of resistance training follow a similar developmental pattern as we would with lacrosse training or conditioning or anything else. You start out with basic skills, lunging, squatting, pressing, pulling, things that can be done body with just your body weight. Then we get into introducing a resistance apparatus, whether it be a piece of PVC pipe or a stick or a medicine ball or a barbell. And then eventually we get into long-term progressive overload. Progressive overload, which I'm going to get into more here in just a minute, basically the idea with progressive overload, you don't really want to start progressive overloading until they're post-pubescent. Can it be done sooner? Absolutely, in some very appropriate cases. But I wouldn't tamper around with that too much. If you wait, there's no question you can do a lot of things to prepare them up to that point. And then when they're at that time period in their life, when they're getting through that pubescent cycle, and you start to progressively overload them, the skill set's already there. So they know how to move, they know how to execute things. Now we're slowly going to implement intensity week to week, day to day, year to year, and you'll see them blossom pretty quickly. So fundamental resistance training skills, push-ups, pull-ups, there's 100 different variations of them. I don't think you need to be limited to what variations you use with young kids, just that they know how to execute them correctly. So people always ask me, well, what if a kid can't do a push-up? Well, then just sit them in a push-up position and have them hold that position for an extended period of time. Then eventually turn that into a slow 3 count down to the floor, or maybe a 5 count down to the floor. Once you can do the both of those, backwards and forwards over and over and over again, then maybe he's ready to try a full push-up. Another idea is to take pillows you can throw underneath his chest and have him do a limited range of motion until he gets better and moves on down. Especially when we're talking female athletes, a lot of times with the upper body work, they need a little bit more development with learning how to do those skills, but you can get pretty creative. Learn how to do a push-up. Learn how to do a pull-up. If a kid can't do a push-up, I don't really need to put him on a bench press yet. It doesn't do me much good. I need him to be able to handle his own body weight, which is going to be pushing off the ground if he ever falls down. Lunging, squatting, a basic lunge. A couple of different things it tells me. For one, is he strong enough to be able to keep his posture upright and to be able to stand and come back right where he started from? But the other thing it tells me a little bit about is, what's his balance like? Is he twisting? Is he leaning? Is he falling over? Is he having a hard time being stable in that area? Which can tell me a lot about what I'm going to do on the field with him in terms of balance and stability training. Rotation. Does he look smooth? Does he look awkward when he rotates? Is he very single plane, or can he turn in different directions and rotate from high to low, low to high? Can he rotate reverse and go back this way with the same velocity that he can going forwards? Take a look at him when they're doing things, when they're throwing med balls. See if he's doing it all with his arms, or is he actually using his hips and his torso when he's throwing things. Take a look at his shot. Is he coming back? Is he able to rotate back far enough to get the velocity that he wants at the angles that he wants? Landing. The biggest thing with landing, this gets preached a lot. You got to teach proper landing mechanics. The biggest thing with landing mechanics, yes, it can save a lot of knee injuries. It can save you a lot of aches and a lot of ibuprofen. It can save you a lot of ibuprofen. The biggest thing with landing that you need to look at is, are they lined up? So if I land with my feet this wide, basically all you're looking for is that my knee is lined up with my foot. If I land with my feet this wide, my knee's over my foot. If I land with my feet here, are my knees over my foot? So the only thing you want to avoid is, if I land here, and then we call this valgus knees, you just don't want the knees to come in. So as long as you can execute that, you've taught landing. When kids are landing, the biggest thing about it that's going to translate into later on is how fast they can re-accelerate. So you got a kid that can sprint around, oh, someone's coming, I got to go back the other way. They need to be able to squat themselves down, turn, and accelerate back the other way. So those landing mechanics in the early days will teach him to be able to slow down faster in a good low position, turn around, and get back the other direction as quick as he can. So while you may not think that, you know, lacrosse guy doesn't really need to get up vertically all that much and then land nice and solid. It's going to translate into other skills later on down the road when he's cutting and decelerating, reaccelerating. Pushing and pulling is just basic pulling, pushing horizontally or even pulling vertically or pulling vertically on the way down, pushing vertically, and then explosive lifting. Explosive lifting gets into weightlifting, with Olympic-style weightlifting, snatching, clean jerking, things like that. That gets on down the more advanced road of training. In terms of being able to do all the things on these lifts, an 8-year-old can do all of them. A 6-year-old can do all of them. A 20-year-old can do all of them. The critical piece is how you progressively overload them, and that's the important part that I want you to take away in terms of when to do that. And again, I can't reiterate enough, the safest bet is once they've gotten past that puberty point, you're pretty safe to go. The other thing is mindset. You got to think about mindset a little bit. If you have a kid that's genuinely invested in putting his time into that area of training, because if he's not, it's not always a great idea to force feed it to him. You'd be better off, if he's passionate about lacrosse, you'd be better off giving him some ideas on what to do on the field with a stick in his hand, and then you can play a little crossover. Create skills for him, say you want him to work on his agility training or his acceleration training, put the stick in his hand and get his mind focused on lacrosse if that's the thing he loves, and take it away from the thing he doesn't love, which is maybe running around Cummins with you 20 minutes after practice. So you can tailor it to how you want. So fundamental resistance training. This is just a couple little pointers. Again, some things to keep in mind. Start with body weight only. Then you can move into a light object, medicine ball, PVC pipe, a light barbell, light dumbbells, something that they can move easily that doesn't deteriorate their technique, and then into a resistance implement, and then eventually progressively overloading that implement as they get stronger. Planning parameters. Ooh, it's getting close. So, big thing about planning, and I've had coaches like, man, coach, I just don't have time to sit down and devise a plan. You don't have to put out a big spreadsheet. It doesn't have to be on Excel. It can be handwritten. It can be on a chalkboard. But basically, you got to understand a few things, and whoever you're working with your team should understand a few things. What season is it? Are we in the preseason? Are we in the middle of our season? Are we in the postseason? Are we in the beginning of our offseason? Where are we in the year? How frequent are we gonna be practicing? How frequent are we gonna be weightlifting? How frequent are we gonna be conditioning? Those are important. It should be based on your needs. If we're a relatively strong team, we may not need to weightlift all that frequently. If we're a relatively fit team, we may not need to run all that frequently. If we're a relatively fit team, but we can't execute our clear, then we may need to spend more time on the clear and less time on the running. How long are these sessions going to be? Everybody's got their own parameters, whether it's governed by your school, by your club, by your wife telling you to hurry up and get home because you don't need to stay there for 4 hours that particular day. Whatever the case is, how long is the duration going to be? Number of exercises, number of sets, number of reps. Our coaching staff does a great job with our practice plan. Every day when I get a practice plan, it tells me specifically what segments we're in, how many minutes we're in those segments. And it gives me an idea of the intensity of those segments, if they're contact or non-contact. So then I have a better understanding of what kind of fatigue we're going to endure. I have a better understanding of how long that practice is going to be. Coach Paul's pretty good. He's better than I am with staying on time, because usually if he says a practice is going to be an hour and 35 minutes, it's usually an hour and 35 minutes. I'm working on about 31 minutes right now, Coach. Thank you. Maybe 31. So the other big key to this is resistance tracking. Keeping a diary. When I start with young kids, it's really easy to get them in a habit. Give them a workout, so you got a little something written up, you give it to them. Just tell them to write down what they do. All right, coach, for my push-ups today, you wanted me to do 20, but I could only get 3 at a time. So I did a bunch of sets of 3 and then a couple of sets of 1 until I got to 20. Just have them jot that stuff down. That way, months later, you can go back, or weeks later, you can go back and you can look at that stuff, and you can get an idea. First off, is Jimmy being diligent? Second off, is Jimmy making progress? Does my program work? It's important to keep track. You're going to have some kids that get really devoted to this, and some coaches that get really devoted to this, and then some that don't. The more that you can keep track of it, the more you can cultivate and you can design and change and tweak your program as the months and years go by. I can tell you in the fourth year of this program, If I gave our strength program we have right now to team one, we'd be hurt. We'd be in trouble. So there's been a lot of development that's gone on in these 4 years. So this is a basic set and rep. This is nothing to live and die by. I get a lot of coaches that ask me, okay, I have no idea how many reps to do. I don't have any idea how many exercises to select, and I don't know how many reps and sets to do. So this is just a basic idea of what a progressive four-month program could look like. 3 to 5 exercises, 2 to 4 sets, of 10 to 20 reps apiece. Starting out in the beginning, you want to do lots of repetitions. They can be very light repetitions. You want to do lots of repetitions, so one, they have a chance to learn skills, and then for two, you're addressing a little bit of work capacity. You're improving their endurance just a little bit. Month two, 4 to 6 exercises, 3 to 5 sets of 8 to 15 reps. It starts to drop a little bit, so the kids can start to increase in speed, increase in intensity. And then as it moves on down, month four, you see 3 to 6 exercises, possibly 4 to 6 sets of 3 to 5 repetitions. This is where you're really starting to ramp intensities up. So the amount of what you're doing starts to drop a little bit. It's got to have an inverse relationship. If you're going to do a ton of stuff, it needs to be relatively low intensity. If you're going to do a little bit of stuff, you can afford to jack the intensity up through the roof. So as long as you have an understanding of where you are with that. All right, conditioning planning. Again, what season is it? How frequently are we conditioning? How long? Number of drills? Are we measuring miles, yardage? How are we taking a look at how much we're doing? Position specific. Am I conditioning position specific? Does my goalkeeper need to run as much as my D-Medi does? Do I have a true FOGO, or do I have a FOGO that plays a lot of offensive minutes? You can define and understand that based on your own team and decide who needs to run what. High minute player versus a low minute player. If you got a high minute player that gets a ton of repetitions in practice, you may not need the same conditioning volume that the low minute player needs when it comes time to condition. But you bet that these guys are going to be expecting, if our number one goes down and number two steps in, you better be fit enough to do number one's job. That's kind of what we have to get them ready for. So you got to kind of balance that too and be able to take a look, know your personnel, so you can prescribe appropriately. Really quick, this gets kind of scientific, but aerobic and anaerobic. The predominance of lacrosse is played through fast glycolysis, which is that second little area there. Bursts of 12 to 30 seconds. The way this works is, the reason I want you to understand is, how much aerobic preparation do we need to do and how much anaerobic preparation do we need to do? Meaning, how many minutes of jogging do we need to do versus how many seconds of sprinting do we need to do? Again, it varies from team to team, from group to group, depending on what your talents are. But in order to be extremely efficient with fast glycolysis, meaning I want Jimmy's our fastest kid, he's explosive, no one in the league can keep up with him. I want him to be able to repeat those efforts over and over and over again throughout the duration of a game and possibly in overtime. So for him to be able to do that early in the offseason, we need to maximize his base of aerobic conditioning in the beginning. When that aerobic conditioning base is expanded wide, then we have a higher ceiling height on what his potential is for repeating those fast, explosive efforts later on down the season. I can't express enough how important it is early in the offseason to establish an aerobic base. And every kid that reads a little bit is going to tell you, coach, we play lacrosse, I don't need to run a mile, I don't need to run 2 miles. It's the last thing that he wants to do. But early in the summer, before our league starts, it's a very important time to address some of those things. Once we get into this time of year, we're doing very few repetitions of long distance. Just about everything we're doing, or actually nothing that we do, is over 36 seconds right now at this particular time. So everything is much shorter, but it's very high intensity. It's all top-end speed kind of work. So I just wanted to give you a brief synopsis of that. So when you talk about the year as a whole, we spend about 70% of our time on anaerobic or sprint work, a short burst, high intensity sprint work, agility training, resistive running, things like that. And about 30% of our year is on our aerobic base. If you looked in a shorter version of our year, if you say in the middle of our season in February and March, it would be about 95% anaerobic and maybe a little sprinkle of some endurance work depending on the week. Conditioning duration and frequency often depends on the practice duration and frequency. Some programs practice 6 days a week, anywhere from an hour and a half to 3 hours a night. You may not need as much supplemental conditioning as you think. And vice versa. One thing to take a very stiff look at, though, is what is your practice makeup like? Are your practices high speed? Are they quick transition from one drill to the next? Is there much downtime? How many kids are standing around during a drill? Look at those types of things, because that will either condition or decondition your team whenever you're going through those practices, especially if you're not doing any supplemental conditioning on the side. 32. Dang. All right, so I try to get through that as fast as I can. Again, this is a topic, this could be a week-long seminar on how to develop young kids. So a couple minutes here, fire away, you can throw some questions, and I'll help out as much as I can. Take a sip of coffee while you think on it. All right, 32 minutes and 42 seconds. Boom. Yes?
Can you give some examples of different things you do with the guys in glycolysis versus fast glycolysis?
Yes, so glycolysis, or fast glycolysis, is basically, it's basically anything from 12 seconds to about 30 seconds, depending on what research you read. And so we use repeat sprints. Any kind of interval sprinting works. Obviously, the more specific you get, if I'm getting really specific, I want our kids in their cleats, in their gear, flak jackets on, helmets on, mouthpiece in their mouth, gloves on. That would be the most specific. And then you can also dummy that down. You can start to strip the gear off, and then you can even get down to where you're changing the surface. You can have them on the grass, you can have them on the track, and change things up that way. So in the off season, we start out a little simpler with track work and things like that, where I get them away from that surface a little bit. It's a little, the nice thing about turf is it's very forgiving on knees and joints and things like that. The thing that kind of sucks about it is that it takes away from your ability to react a little bit. It gives when you push on it, so it can actually slow you down when you're changing direction. Whereas the old school AstroTurf and things like that, when you push on it, it gives a direct return. So you can see guys be a little bit quicker in terms of surfaces like that. Changing the surface up can change up the intensity and then also, we're fortunate we have a sand pit, so we can do some work in the sand pit as well. And that adds another level of intensity. It actually provides a little bit of resistance because you're burying your foot down in the sand and having to recover and get into the next stride. So a really simple version, we use a series of gassers often. For me, a full gasser is the width of the field. Usually our practice field is an indoor football field. It's about 55 yards long, give or take a couple of feet. Over and back, twice, two round trips, what we call a full gasser. A full gasser standard time for our team is 36 seconds. And so 36 seconds is enough to challenge our fastest guys. Most of them can make that no problem. But it's kind of in the middle to where some of our slower guys, it's challenging, they can make it, but it's a little tough on them. And then we can play with those times a little bit. So if I got defensive midfielders that can run 32 seconds, then I may cut their time down a little bit compared to, say, a goalkeeper that's struggling with 36. A half gasser would be over back in 16 seconds, and then a quarter gasser straight across in 7 seconds. when we run these things, there's two things I manipulate. The time, so I can manipulate, if it's early in the off season, we're doing quarters. I may give them 9 seconds. We start out nice and easy, build them into it. So I can adjust the times, the goal times that we're running on them, and then I can also adjust the rest periods, which I'm a bigger fan of. I like to try to keep the times as standard as I can. But then we start out in the early off season, I'll start out around a 3-to-1 rest to work ratio when we're running. So if it takes us, if it takes us 15 seconds to run a drill, then we get 45 seconds of break. We'd be a 3-to-1. Eventually, getting to our most sport-specific would be a 1-to-1 work-to-rest ratio, or even for some guys, less than that. and so you can manipulate those rest periods and those goal times, especially when you have a sprint drill like a gasser, and it's very standard, the distance is standardized. You can adjust those rest periods and those goal times to fit your team and to fit your time of year. And then you can progress them as well. Your team starts to crush the times that you originally started them on 6 weeks earlier, and you can start to progress those times and progress those intensities. And if you'll email me, we have endless. We have all kinds of different durations. We have different activities where they're chasing each other, more competitive drills and things like that. So another topic I could probably talk a couple days on. But great question. Anything else? My email address is up there on the front, so if you guys ever do have questions, fire me emails. I answer them as fast as I can. I can provide you with slides. I can provide you with videos. We'll help out our lacrosse community as much as possible. So thanks for giving me your ear, and good luck this season.
Cool. How's everybody doing tonight?
Good.
You got a pulse, right? All right, I was going to call this Offense for Dummies, but that book's already been written. If you were here the last time, you probably remember I have a pretty simple approach to most of this stuff. I think one of the smartest things you can do for yourself when you're talking about offense is make it as simple as possible. Right? Because it's got to work for your least smart player. Right? Plenty of us have had guys on our team, too, where the least intelligent guy is one of the most athletic ones. Right? It happens. Right? So if he can't understand your offense, you're in trouble. Okay? A couple things as we get going.
There's a couple handouts. You guys email me and you didn't get one. We only have like 10 guys here at the first one, so I sort of made copies for 20, and there's a lot more people here, but that's good to see. Okay, so if you send me an email, I'll get this out to you. It's basically everything that's up there is in the packet, and it's pretty self-explanatory from there. But my base offense, the offense that I like to teach, and I shouldn't even say my, but it's not mine. I didn't invent it, right? They've been doing it for 70 years, okay? What I'm here to tell you, though, is that it works at a high level.
It works.
Oops. We're going backwards. There we go. Motion principles. There we go. So, all right, who in here counts from up top? Who in here counts from behind? Up top?
Yes.
From behind?
No, we're out.
All right. So that's why we're going to draw it up, just so there's no confusion. Okay? That's a crease. There's no tackling. There's no tackling. There's no tackling. Midi, we usually have the guy that's covered by the pole buried to start out. Right? There's some good things you can do by pulling him out also, though. Okay? So I used to count from up top, so this would be a 2-3-1, right? But now I count from the bottom, so it's a 1-3-2. 1-3-2 motion is Phil Jackson's offense, essentially, for lacrosse, triangle offense. Who here has heard of that before? Everybody, right? Because it's the first thing you should learn. And the last thing. Everything else in between is just us thinking we're football coaches and get way too creative. Okay? So the triangle motion offense, whatever you want to call it, we just yell motion. My hand signals for that is just this, right? Motion, okay? Every little piece that we change after that, we just add a word to motion, okay? And most of the time, that extra word just has to do with what the midfielders are doing. That's where a lot of the variation comes from at first for us, is in the midfield triangle, okay? So if you take a look up here, just to start, these are some basic principles. I've got three things in my hands now. But I think it's good to have a language to talk to your players with, okay? So if you look up here, one spot, two spot, half spots are the wings, three, four, five across the top, six spots the crease. So now we can talk about, like, okay, dodging the four spot. This is what we're looking for there. I need you to get to the five spot here, right? I also talk, obviously, X behind, okay? But I also talk about X up top a lot, right? One of the things when I was playing at Hopkins that was fairly new then, or at least it was a hot, trendy thing to do, started to become, was to keep the ball in front of the cage and throw back a lot, right? Because if you throw back, whoever catches the ball is in front of the cage and they can still shoot,
quicker usually to get the ball on the backside if you keep it in front of the goal. Right? That being said, we still play through X plenty here because there's reasons to do that. You have your attack triangle, A1, A2, A3. Any of the three guys can be in any of the spots. Okay? Down here, the midfield triangle, same thing. Any of the three guys can be in any of the three spots. These asterisks here, 10 and a hash, 10 and a hash, the island, 5 and 5, and the opposite island. Okay, I actually like the island to be a little bit higher than 5 and 5 too, maybe like 7 yards high and 5 yards wide. If you're going to try to do those question marks and shoot from the island, you need to get higher than 5 yards to still have some angle left. Okay? Up top here, you see like the hash marks. That's the football hash marks. Best thing I think on a field as far as marking. Right? We add some extra lines that are tight to the crease that we call tangents too, which give us our midfielders like an actual alley that they're really looking for. Okay? Now one thing about this whole thing, right? This over here. That's the set as you draw it up, right? But they don't really always stand right in those places. This isn't football. They don't start standing still. You have to move the entire time, right? So all these guys have to move a great deal to move the ball. The ball's here. At our level, we're not going to start dodging from inside the box, standing right there, right? We need to get the ball around the horn, and we need to wind it up, so to speak, right? I call that climbing the ladder, right? And that's just an anticipation thing. So if this guy, if they're going to allow us to dodge down the alley to our strong hand, we're going to spin the ball in a fashion, right, where we work. These are all V cuts in and out to get the ball, obviously. But he's going to end up winding way up here, so that he can get a good north-south run of people to start off, right? Because the first part of any offense, and they'll say it up there, you got to dodge to score, right? You have to, the dodge has to be legitimate. If the defense reacts to it, pieces start moving around, that's where the mistakes are made, okay? I'm not going to read straight down this thing. That's why I handed it out to you guys. We'll just cover some of the highlights. So we move, right? Our rules are simple, too. We're not always in this 1-3-2. The reason I like this triangle motion offense is because it's a 1-3-2, which is a great set to do some set plays out of as far as mumbos or cross screens, right? But there's also elements of a 2-2-2 offense in it. And at times, as soon as we get one dodge and one pop off the crease, we're in an umbrella or a 2-1-3, which I used to call a 3-1-2 from the top, right? Everybody's seen the umbrella offense with all the niggas up high. As soon as we dodge and fade off the crease, that's where we are. Right? And if the ball goes behind, we have a two-man game that takes place kind of between the midi and the attacking, that it's an element of a 2-2-2 offense. So it's not just one thing, right? A motion offense is everything, all at the same time. And you're not necessarily going to be in predictable places all the time. That's the way I like to teach it. Our rules are so simple, you might look at me right now and be like, why don't I work for Michigan? This is simple. This is so simple, right? These are the rules. Somebody's dodging at you, you get through to the crease. Okay? If you're on the crease and the dodge takes place, you fade and you pop away from it. That's it. That is it. Literally, that's it. Right? Groundbreaking, right? It works. Right? The whole idea being split the field in half, right? Ball side, weak side, or back side, whatever you want to call it. Offense, in my opinion, is drawing a double team on the ball side, getting the ball to the weak side as quickly as possible. If you're great at it, you'll have a shot over on the weak side. Someone will screw up, someone will be open, you'll be able to shoot the ball. Right? With defenses that play at a high level, the first time through is not necessarily going to beat the defense unless you're giving them a look they've really never seen before and they play it wrong. Right? So offense just becomes, every time the ball switches, you switch, obviously. Draw a double team here, get it here. Draw a double team here, get it here. Draw a double team here, get it here. Back and forth, right? And if we can do that quickly, we're going to have a lot of success on offense. Much easier said than done, right? These rules are simple, but it's easier said than done because athleticism plays a huge role in it, and stick work will absolutely trump everything you do, right? You have to play it to your level of stick work. If you have great sticks and the stick work doesn't break down before the defense, you're going to get a great opportunity, right? But if the stick work breaks down from defensive pressure or just exchanges on the perimeter, then it's a whole other story, right? So stick work, fundamental at its core, is the most important thing you can do to develop offensive play, right? I have an old saying, the three works, right? Stick work, footwork, hard work. It's pretty much all it takes to be a good lacrosse player. Great stick, right? The guys that were here last time, like, made jokes about myself, I always do. I'm not a great athlete by any means,
great stick, and I know where to be, and that got me pretty far, right? So stick work's the one thing you can always work on, too. There's nothing keeping any kid out there from having a great stick, right? It's not magic, right? He's not going to instantly say, I want to have a great stick, and he's going to wake up tomorrow and he's going to have a great stick, right? You have to pound the wall, right? You have to shoot a lot. I get that question all the time. How'd you become such a great shooter? I've shot a million lacrosse balls in my life. That's pretty much how, right? I've broken some windows, right? I pounded the paint off my parents' house, plenty. But it's because you just get the reps. You have to geek out on lacrosse at some point, and you have to geek out on the stick work part. I'm a great stickler player. Okay, does that make sense? So, if we start to move into some of this basic motion stuff, like I said, we're not going to read through all the principles. But the first look that I like to teach these guys, okay? And it's the two-man game aspect that I'm talking about off of this motion. After this guy dodges, here's the mini. That's my little squiggly stick little ball. This is the way we're going to move in our base offense. We fade the guy off the crease unless we say something else, okay? So, as this dodge starts to take place, we've got a clear through and a curl back. We're going to step wide. We're going to pinch first. He'll end up going behind the goal if the ball goes behind the goal. He's going to pinch to the backside pipe, and this guy pops out to this space. This guy follows the X up top, right? So very quickly, you see, this is that umbrella that I'm talking about. Kind of two guys low, one on the crease, three across the top. Okay? Forget these circles for a moment. This guy's out of here. You gotta reset. Unfortunately, low tech is the best way to teach this stuff. So bear with me. Okay? We've now moved a little bit for this dodge. We're at the pinch. This attack is cleared through. We got a midi here, and this is the dodging. Okay? There's your sort of 2-1-3. Count from the bottom again. No matter which direction this guy gives it up, hopefully he's drawn a slide because that's his number one job. Right? First dive in the possession is to draw a slide. If he goes forward, I call that a push pass. Pushes the ball forward. Okay. If he cracks it back to this median X up top, I call it a pull pass because you pull it across your body. Some people call it a spike, throwback, whatever you want to call it. Right? We work a lot on both throwing it across our bodies and stepping back as we do that. And then if we're under heavy pressure and the guy's out of the pole maybe, we'll teach him to circle and throw back. Takes a little bit more time, but it's safer most of the time. Okay? So no matter what, either direction, whichever direction this guy throws, let's say he goes here, this guy then steps back and moves it over and starts to push. Here's your aspect of a 22 offense. These guys will start to move a little bit. The clear through is happening. He immediately finds the guy who just slid to him, because as soon as he throws it, right, that the guy that slide just slid to stop his dodge, he goes, okay, my job's done. Right? We're going to try to pick on that. And we're going to set a screen immediately, and he's going to cut off it. And there's your 2-2-2 offense. Right? It's only a 2-2-2 momentarily, obviously, because we're going to start to push this, get it back up top, this guy rebalances out, and then we're very briefly in our 1-3-2 again until we got it. Right? But that's the first look. It took us 2.5, maybe 3 weeks to get it this fall. Because, like, the dodger, more times than not, does the same exact thing that the defense does. He dodges, he draws a slide, he throws it somewhere, and then he goes, my job's done. The best time to be an off-ball player is right when you give the ball up, right? Because everybody has that. They can't even help themselves. They relax for a second. So if he can get it in his head, all right, I don't have to necessarily do that much. I don't have to make a world-beater play here. I just need to draw a slide and move it and then get ready for this cut. I'll probably be open. Right? The day we did it in practice this fall was like an epiphany, and like the next four possessions, everybody did it. It's like, yeah, look at me, you know? And that's easy, right? So that's the first look that we look for. I might screw this up, so I'm going to walk over here and hit the space bar. This is going to be an example of that look. This was probably actually the second time we got it. See the dodge? We're going to spin it here. This is a little bit longer clip. Like you see, guys moving in their spots. The guy up top there climbing the ladder, Mikey Slosher, remember that name? Dodges hard, gets a good slide, moves the ball forward. Not even a great exchange here. We throw it one extra time, he cuts through. That's hard, right? Pretty simple. So again, that's our first base look. That's like the principle of this offense. We go from a 1-3-2, have a little bit of a two-man game, right? Because we're briefly in a 2-1-3, and then all of a sudden we're back in our base set again. Okay? Now, like I was just saying, a lot of the variations that we do start to be from the midfield. This is a slide essentially exhibiting that fade action, right? The two dotted lines are the two options you have in the pass. The push pass forward, right? And the pull pass back. That's your fade. That's what we're talking about when we say fade. The guy with crease is fading to the backside. Okay? The first variation that we look for off of this becomes a pop, which is pretty simple. Okay? But I've got the next clip here. There's a couple. Bear with me, this is old film, right? We didn't get any of these perfect for Michigan yet. We've only had three competitions, so this is Drexel from a couple years ago. But this is going to be a motion fade. And most teams, most defenses, this isn't a knock on Auburn by any means, but most defenses are going to play this better, and it's going to be a little harder to do this than just this. Okay? No? Can you use this button?
There's going to be two clips here. The first one,
the fade guy's going to be wide open. He's going to bury the ball, right? There's throwback. Step in, right in the ring, 10 yards, pretty easy. Next clip here, they play it a little bit better, okay? It's the same exact thing. They get there, but then they're not ready to support the next dodge, right? And again, that's that concept of draw the whole team on this side, get it to the backside, dodge again if you're not wide open right off the bat.
Does that make sense? We'll let it riff here one more time so everybody can see it.
This pinch here is huge because it occupies this guy. That's who should be getting there at times if they rotate fully, right? Their confusion up top is where they're helping from as far as the two. But this is, these are literally back-to-back possessions too, the next step up. Now, it's easy for me to sit up here and say this, right? The guy who buries the first one's the number one pick in the NFL draft. I've got some pretty good guys to work with, right? Same thing is true in Michigan. The second guy, right, has the most wicked crossover split you could ever imagine type of thing. So, right, there's development that needs to take place here with the Dodgers, right, but that's why I'm lucky, that's why I coach Palos across, because they're all pretty good so far, right? So I've got something good to work with. You guys got to do the hard work so that I get good guys to work with. So keep it up, okay? Next thing here, here's your first variation, right, the pop. Instead of fading this midi out the backside, he's going to pop out the top, and the midi that would have stepped into the middle just falls down the backside into the same space, right? Into the same space. The idea for me, I'm not necessarily in a game, once we get to the right point, calling either one of these things out specifically. Does that make sense? The idea is that the midfielders, since the attack moves the same way for either one, the midis communicate to each other which one's taking place. And all that has to happen is this guy's dodged, and that's all he's worried about, right? So M1 and M2 have to talk to each other and say, I'm popping, so you drop down the backside, right? Or we're just in normal motion, so I'm going to fade, you step over, and we're good to go, okay? When teams get really good at this, they can bury it, right, on their own, and that becomes harder to play. That make sense? So again, let's see what we got next here. This is one from Michigan. This is from practice. There's a couple sources of all this film. This is going to be a really good angle, too, here. Okay, this is after an extended possession where we spin it again. We didn't have anything the first time. And this one isn't exactly perfect. We do pop and we do get a great shot after it, but it's because two guys make great plays because of it. Okay, we're going to get to our shape here. You see the dodge, pop out the top. He was kind of already in that shooting spot. If we could get the ball out of our stick here quicker, we'd be even better off. They get a little adjacent help, and that's your shooting spot, right? For me, I think it's really important for your attackmen to be able to play as close to the crease and as close to goal line extended as they can, because the closer they are to those spots, the more likely they are to occupy defenders, right? Cover yourself. If you can cover yourself, they can't help off of you for free, okay? You might lose a backup every once in a while, right? But more times than not, they're going to be in a more dangerous situation, right? They're going to be in a more dangerous position, which helps you way more in the long run. So that's your motion pop. Next variation of stuff. Motion X, right? Very simple here. We'll get back on the board for this. So all we've talked about so far is the middies initiating, right? Motion X is something that we do early on or
change? Rather than just what we're playing already? Beautiful. We'll catch it.
Pretty good one, sorry.
Yeah, nice.
Good work. Way to go, Andy.
So motion X. Pretty complex names here I've got, right? Motion with a dodge from X. Like I said, what was the first thing we said? Keep your offense simple.
Keep it really, really, really simple.
The reason for that, and Coach Ball can attest to this, when I was interviewing for this job, I sort of gave him my whole philosophy. Obviously, we talk a lot about lacrosse. We talk about direction of program, yada, yada, yada. But my reasoning for having like one offense that you're really good at, and it's really simple, is it makes the in-game adjustments very simple. Right? Depending on how they're going to play something, I know exactly what to do with this offense to combat that. Right? I know what to do if they're not going to let us out of it, and they're going to make a sweep. We got that in. We'll get to it. Right? It just makes the adjustments very simple. Obviously, we're only talking about man-to-man stuff up here tonight. Zone will be another segment that we can get back together for. But keep it simple so that your in-game adjustments are simple, right? When we do this, the attacking on the wing need to pinch a little bit tighter because they're not sure which direction they're going to go at first, right? Otherwise, it is a little bit more of a bunch where these guys are inside the box, right? Just probably standing on it, to be honest with you, if that's their offensive box. But it's a pretty simple concept. Again, I mean, if he's going to push to his strong hand, we get a shallow back cut, okay? We get a fill to X, that's the attack triangle moving together, right? We get a little more vertical back cut. When I say back cut, I just mean, imagine I'm this guy's defender, okay? And I'm standing up here, that's the goal back there somewhere. Back cut meaning back that way, make him open so he can't see the ball. We don't want to cut in front of him where he can see the ball and cover you at the same time. Make him turn his head, okay? Because half the time they're going to be looking down that way anyway. You know, you see the defender at the back of his head, that's where you go. Okay? So he's going to cut behind his defender. This guy's going to swing over the top, and he's going to pop out that way. Same motion, just rotating. Okay? Pretty simple. Obviously, it would be vice versa if this guy pushed left-handed. But that's it for the most part. What you're going to see here, and it's funny, my reaction on this one, this is probably one of the first nights that you did 6-on-6 this fall. But the guy picks the ball off the shot out of the end line. The offense immediately knows that we're in it, right? They get to their spots. We move hard. I'm screaming after he scores this goal. Way to go. Look. Everybody's moving off ball. Nobody slides. Right? Because everybody's worried about staying with their man who was moving. The best part about this is that the diagonal guy, he ends up pushing left-handed, right? The diagonal guy, the minute it faded, popped off to the backside, is wide open. He didn't even have to shoot it. He just looked diagonal and bang, it's there. Take a look at this. We'll see it a couple times here. So shot out of bounds. You see the guys in the maze, they're pointing each other to the right spots, right? We push hard, we react. You see the diagonal step down guy? He's still standing there by himself. I'll reset it and I'll try to pause it. It's difficult in this video format, but okay. Here we go. Now the Dodger obviously makes a great play here, but this is what I'm talking about, right here. Everybody see him? Right here, wide open, and he stays that way until the goalie's breaking out of the back. That's the primary look, okay? Because more times than not, they're going to try to go quicker than that. Does that make sense? That's the primary look, though.
What's next? Motion sweep. Yep, we talked about the sweeps. Okay, so
big game plan defensively. Okay, these guys are good alley dodgers. Let's not let them dodge their strong hand in the alleys. Okay, so we got a sweep now. All it really adds in for us is one extra step. The minis have to move twice instead of once. That's it. Okay? And we combat this two different ways, depending on where they're going to slide from or if they're going to slide quick to the sweep. Okay? Again, our basic shape. They're no longer going to let this guy go down that alley, right? He's a righty. They're going to force him left-handed. All I mean by the attack does the same exact thing. The attack is going to move as if this is a left-handed out-of-bounds. Okay? The middies just have to go through an extra step of movement. And what that is, I talk a lot in all the break with this stuff is that if we're setting up sweeps, I don't want the ball to rotate into this guy from this midi. This midi has to have time to get out of the way, right? Because if he throws and then he has to get out of the way, it just heads off his switch, and I call it bottling it up. You've allowed the defense to bottle up the offense right there. They just play sides, and boom, you're stuck. You got to get into something else. If you spin the ball the opposite way, so it's always an attacker on the wing, throwing it up to the midi, it's going to sweep. This guy have plenty of time to get out of the way, so they can't just slide quickly and bottle it up, okay? So on this pass up here, this guy's going to start working his way out, this guy's going to work his way in, okay? Now we start sweeping, they're already gone, okay? And the attack starts to move like it's a regular left-handed out of that, okay? Does that make sense? Now the other thing we like to do out of this, and to be honest with you, I use this term a lot. I call it organic offense. Let the kids figure it out. Put them in decent places. Tell them to move. Give them simple rules, and they'll figure out ways to attack them. Okay? We call it like three stack or bunch. We're going to sweep. Lots of times what will happen, instead of moving early from this guy, when this guy gets the ball, this mini is just going to come down top center. He's going to carry it to the middle as much as he can. So we've got one, two, three in a stack. And then it's very simple for us for him to just dodge, fade, and that guy's already in the spot he needs to be in, and we're playing our offense like we normally are. Right? So, oh dear, they're forcing us to our offense on the sweep. It just turns into a lefty out of the pile of power dodge. And again, I'm lucky coaching a lot of really good players, really good midfielders that are two-handed. So our success depends on us being pretty good with our offhands, especially at the midfield. Maybe less so at the attack, right? But especially at the midfield. Because if that sort of defensive game plan, just forcing you to your offhand, is going to jam you up, then I'd be out of the job a long time ago. Right? So you got to develop offhand midfielders, especially at this level. And like I said, you guys have a lot to do with that. You can hammer that home, right? Before they ever get here. That makes a big difference for me. Okay, so a little motion sweep. This clip here is going to be a lot more like that three-stack type situation, or the bunch. And again, this is after a really, really long possession, okay? And what ends up happening here is they give something up that they would usually cover easily at the beginning of the possession. You see the three stack? Everybody's tight, and they miss the little curl through, okay? So we'll reload this real quick. I'll try to pause it. Long possession. We talk a lot, too, about expanding and contracting, okay? If we've played offense and we haven't gotten what we wanted and everything's tight to the cage at that point, it doesn't make sense to try to force your way through a brick wall, right? We need to then spin the ball and let the whole thing expand back out again and get the defense stretched out again before we attack. This is a great example of possession doing that, okay? Like I said, this is probably at the end of like a minute and a half. We've already been playing offense. So this is like the fourth or fifth dodge. We do a good job of stretching them back out. Sorry. We stretch them back out. We move it over. We get to our bunch or our three stack. We start to compress again because we're not sure which way he's going to go. And like I said, they miss the curl through. Again, Coach Broshut will attest, they cover that 9 times out of 10 if it's the first dodge of the possession. But the longer the possession goes, the more likely there's going to be a defensive mistake. It's just the way it is. What you got to make sure as an offensive coach is that your stick work and your scheme doesn't break down before the defense breaks down. Right? That's the game in a nutshell. Who's dictating to who? Right? Who's gonna blink first? Right? And stick work's the biggest part of that for the offense. All right. At the outset, we talked a little bit about the great opportunity for some set plays out of this basic shape, right? The 1-3-2. Again, I have super complicated names for these. We're in a 1-3-2, so the first one's called 131. As complex as I get, is I get real sneaky and I call it 5. All we're doing is adding 1 + 3 + 1, 5. So if the team would play a lot, they hear me screaming 131, their defensive coach starts yelling, "Watch out for the Mumbo! Watch out for the Mumbo!" So I just yell 5 instead. All of a sudden it's something different, right? No, it's the same thing. Right? But anybody, side note here, where did the name Mumbo come from? don't know where it came from either. It's just always been called that. Right? So our lumbo plays, our cross screens, they're all dependent. Where the dots come from is all going to depend on what hand that player is. Okay? And out of a timeout, this might not always be a midi. This could be an attack move. If we got someone we want to do this with, we'll change the spots around a little bit. Right? But what is this guy's hand? Okay? We're going to do it just like the video here. So we're going to pretend this guy's a left-handed player. Okay, we'll just get a little LA set. Which means we're going to dodge from here. Okay, there's your off guy. There's your midi with the ball. The best part about this stuff when you're always playing that motion is it's a great mix-up. Right? So is kind of the box hybrid offense. If you're always playing the motion that we play, it's a great mix-up. It's a great change of pace. You can catch people out. Okay? So it all starts the same. It's an alley dodge right from the midfield after he's climbed the ladder. If he draws a slide here, this stuff is really, really tough to cover. Anybody know the best defense for mumbos? Don't slide. Because we're trying to run a play. Right? If you don't slide, usually you're not supposed to. They'll end up shooting from 13 and I'll yell and pull my hair out when I was laughing at it. But, you know. So here's your mumbo screen, right? We teach this two ways. I teach him to curl up to the ball, right? If the defender's going to try to fight through for their own shot, curling off the field, then they'll start looking back. All right? There's other situations where I'll teach these guys to scrape back off it, almost like step back off the mumbo, and then we'll kick it through actually get something on the backside to do that. So again, if they can get off of it and curl up to the top side for their own shot at increased angle as far as the passing angles to the backside, great, right? The other thing the step off to the back does, if he goes that way, it allows this slip to happen for this attack. You get a better angle to beat. Does that make sense? So, first things first though, when we come off this mumbo, this guy's job is to draw a slide and throw it here as soon as he sees the slide. This guy handles it, his first look is to the backside here. While this is taking place, your X attacking needs to get to what I call the pinch spot, so that hopefully his defender can't help with the mumbo. Anytime you're defending mumbos and you need to slide, which if, I'm trying to think who was dodging in this one, which when Mikey Slosser's dodging right-handed, you need to slide, right? So anytime you need to slide here, you've got to get a defender from the backside over to help on this stuff so you can cover it up, okay? So that's why he comes to the pinch. Again, after we throw it to the mumbo guy, who's now curling up the field with the ball, he's looking diagonal, and if we did our job, there's a 3-on-2 on the backside, and we've got them rotating, and we're all stepping up to it. One more is right to the puck. Okay? The clip that I found of this, again, this is all new stuff, so I don't have as much video of Michigan guys doing it as I'd like. But the clip I found of this, it's an amazing pass, and we don't even need the one more. It ends up with a 10.5 shot on the backside. Okay? Again, all precedented off of the Dodger drawing a slide the first time. This is from a fall scrimmage this fall. So again, if you look, we're 3 yards from the midfield line there, right? That's climbing the ladder. That's winding it up, right? You get a superior athlete with great north-south ability dodging from up there, the defense is going to react. Get a little bit of a cross screen, hit the mumbo, diagonal, step down, right? What makes this play is actually not even the mumbo guy or the dodger. Can you guys see my cursor?
Yes.
Okay, so it's the guy setting the screen here, right? His slip after he sets the screen is what makes the play here. Watch what happens. So he slips, and this defender corrects to it, right? He goes to cover it up, and that's what opens up that skip lane. Sorry, we'll reload here. Back. His slip inside, defender checks to it and then can't get back, right? And the two guys down low do a great job just because they know how open that top guy is. And they kind of like step back and lower to occupy those guys and it creates a 10-yard shot. At our level, a 10-yard shot's a layup. Has to be. How many of those did we take tonight? In the last 3 weeks? Hundreds, right? At the Division I level, a 10-yard shot with your hands free is a layup. You better be good at that, right? Because it's too hard to get total dunks, right? I can create plenty of 10-yard step downs in a game, right? I can't guarantee you I'm going to create 10 one-on-one situations with the goal. But we can create 10 to 15 10-yard step downs in a game. So if you're great at those, you're in good shape.
Okay? This next one, you're going to have to bear with me. Some of the film stuff, like, wasn't quite compatible. But
the next step of this, 131 or this mumbo play, is just what we call 132. So the same type of thing, the only difference being it's a sweep to set it up, okay? And we'd have to use this against one of those defensive game plans again that says we weren't going to be allowed to have the out. So we have to set it up with a sweep. Again, trying to think which way the film one that I have here worked out. I think this guy's already in the film, okay? So they're going to make us sweep to get to where we want to, which just means this guy's going to sweep. Everything else works exactly the same. This guy's just going to shallow cut under and fill back to the back side. That's your mumbo and your curl, getting through the pinch spot, and then curling up the field a little bit. In the film here, this guy's going to get the shot from right there, stepping down. Okay? But again, it's very important in this one, too. Just like the sweeps, ball's got to rotate that way into him so that this guy can get through the crease and out the backside without his defender heading off the cup. Okay? So the direction of the ball rotation is very important. Again, simple names. 131, my guys know it's a ball side. Pally dodge, 132, they know it's a sweep to get there. Okay, very simple. I got to X out of this momentarily. This film wouldn't bend correctly. Well, we got it for you.
Let's see here. All right, 132 versus PSU. Full screen. There we go. Anybody see it? So the Dodger already has the ball, right? Number 21 here is the guy that's going to cash in on the end. Here's your guy setting the mumbo screen. This is the guy curling off of it. Okay? He has time to get through underneath. They sweep. They hedge off of it. You throw that diagonal first, and that's like a 12-yard step down. All right? Again, we'll go back, watch it again. Come on. There we go. Bear with me. Just that thing I was talking about. This defender from PSU here hedges off of this to be the help, okay, which is actually a pretty good idea. He just hedges a little too far and they don't get back in time. If they'd have played this mumbo better, we wouldn't have even been able to throw it there and they would have been successful. But they get it off. It results in like a 12-yard step down from a guy who can shoot from there easily, right? And it's just a little bit of ball movement, a little misdirection. You get the ball to the backside with somebody's hands free. Again, it's simple offense, right? Simple offense. Let's see what's next here. Just skipped it. Good. Last. This is all we have in at this point at Michigan. Okay. We'll get a little more in depth, but to be honest with you, not that much more. But 14 short is my invert. Again, shouldn't say mine. I didn't invent it. Just use it. Okay. Any good offensive coach, seriously, just steal stuff from other people and try to do it better. That's all we do. Easy job. The talented people in this room are defensive coaches. Straight up. They're smarter, they got a game plan, they have to worry about all this stuff. We just try to run by people and handle the ball. Pretty simple. So, 14 short, again, super complicated name, right? We're going to get in a 1-4-1 and we're going to dodge against a short stack from behind. 14 short. Right? If I'm calling this out in the game, it'll be 14 short and one of my guys' numbers. Okay? So, 14 short, 5. Okay? 14 short, 22. So they know who it is and how they're going to get to it. Okay? Most of the time it's a mini. Sometimes at the end of the it could totally be an attackman. Okay? The film that you're going to see is an attackman who's already, we've already been playing some offense. He's got a short stick out of some sort of a rotation and a personnel change. And we get our guys to the spots pretty quickly. The one thing I like to teach everybody with this too is it's so much more important getting guys to the spots than who's in them. Right? Because it's all about the shape here. In an ideal world, this is our right-handed finishing attackman on the wing. This is our left-handed finishing attackman on the wing. This is the attackman that's left over. That's your roll-off guy. Okay. This spot here, I call the crash spot. This is like 15 yards easily, like 15 yards high slot. Okay. And then this is the step-down guy who's probably got his back foot at the top of the box. So this is a little higher. Okay.
here's the other thing to think about. Getting guys to the spot is more important than who's in them, right? So maybe this mini, or maybe this is our left-handed attacker. You got a short stick. You got to get somebody to the lefty spot, even if he's right-handed. The only adjustment I make is if this guy's right-handed, he just plays a little bit higher and tighter so that he can step down to that shot. Right? Pretty simple adjustment. Again, keep the offense simple, the adjustments are easy. So the only rule with the dodge here is it's got to be one hard move and go, because there's people moving off ball that need to know which way you're going to go. Right? So if you can't dance back and forth back there, that gets us all messed up. The timing's not right. The term we kind of use with this too is we're going to flush the middle of the field. Okay? So when this guy goes and dodges hard, he rolls off, he flushes down or crashes, and what that creates most of the time is a pretty simple read. I mean, obviously, if this guy's beating his guy and nobody slides, he's going to come around and dunk him, right? Simple. Okay, but most defenses, they're going to get something going here. A lot of teams will go pretty early to this for designate a slide, right? We've all seen that. Kind of like the zone up top, you're going to designate a hot guy, he's going to go pretty early, meeting the GLE. If this works correctly, the read is pretty simple. You're reading the crash guy and the step-down guy, right? Because the guy that's supposed to cover the step-down guy has to go with the crash. If he doesn't, go to the crash guy. Pretty simple, right? If he goes with the crash guy, we try to skip it through, again, creating something like a 12, 13-yard step-down shot. So you're going to want one of your better step-down shooters up there playing that spot, okay? Better defenses will throw some sort of a combination look at you here and maybe come down off the wing guys. Okay. And our rule for the dodger here is if the slide gets to your hands before you can read the crash or the skip through, just throw it to the ball side wing. Right? And if you just throw it to the ball side wing, what I teach that guy is his first look is the opposite ball side wing. Because the defense is rotating at this point to some extent, and we just want to skip it right through their rotation. Okay? Sometimes they get a stick on it, sometimes they don't. The Drexel team I've been with for the last few years killed Virginia with this for like 3 years. And then, you know, Mark Hockney would like pick up something in front when they gave it over time for like 3 years straight. So just a bone on my side. It works, and it works against really good teams and really good defensive teams. Okay? So the film you're gonna see though, they slide so early that this guy reads it, steps back, throws it back to the guy who's filling behind X for him, and they screw up their recovery up here so that it's just a throw back there. Shot and goal. Okay, so that's like the pretty option off all of this.
Yeah, just a quick question with that. If he reads the coma there, or is he always rolling back to the guy busted rolling off? Do you teach your guys that? Or
yes, especially if they're going super early.
Yeah.
And you'll see it here on the film as we crank that up. This slide is so early. He does a great job. It's one hard move. They slide super early. He rolls back before they ever get to his hands. And basically, it was probably an offensive midi up top, who was stuck in on defense, gets lazy with the rotation. He says, no, you go over there. They never get there, right? And it creates a pretty simple opportunity for us. So again, the best part about this one too, another point with teaching this, you gotta get the guys to the spots before you start to dodge, but you don't wanna, like you literally wanna dodge as soon as they're anywhere near those spots. So right here, you can see on the film, it looks like a little bit of a jumbled mess, right? What I can tell you, here's your guy with the short stick. This is the guy that's going to be the righty step down over here. Here's your roll off, crash, step down on top, and this guy is getting to the lefty wing late. This is our left-handed attacker, okay? And I'm pretty sure this happened to be a left-handed midi too. We just knew he needed to get there. We start to dodge just as he's getting there. They slide incredibly early. We roll back in time, right? Redirect it through X. And like I said, a short stick up top took the easy route out, and he sent the pole all the way through, which you don't want to do. You want to bump through the crease and get somebody out there quickly, obviously. And as a result, it's a pretty simple look on the backside. Okay? Pretty simple. And again, what makes the play, though, the guy's recognizing the slide early. It's one hard move, he goes, they react, which on most converts, most teams are going to react pretty quickly. And the stick work from that point on is great, right? The biggest thing I talk about with my offense all the time, too, is the best skill you can possibly have for us is be the guy that can draw a slide, draw a double team, right, and get that ball out while two people stuck on the ball and then the ball's gone, well, we got an advantage somewhere else, right? And all you should ever be thinking about with offensive stuff is finding that 3-on-2 or 4-on-3 on the backside, right? And then as much as you can simplify that equation, okay, which, is, again, is that concept of cover yourself, right? We got a 3-on-2 on the backside, cover yourself so that someone's open. Does that make sense? It's kind of counterintuitive, but you've got to be somewhere dangerous so that the defense has to account for you, and then you can pick apart that 3-on-2, 4-on-3. If you can make a 4-on-3 on the backside, 3-on-2, great. If you can, from the 3-on-2, make a 2-on-1, great. And then if they rotate out the field, which a lot of this stuff is designed to do, and you step up from X, and we dump it down to you, the one more pass, then all of a sudden you're 1-on-0 with the goalie, and we like our chances there. Does that make sense? I told you I have a pretty simple approach to offense, okay? But I don't see why anybody else makes it any more complicated, right? You'd be surprised what would happen if you just give talented players simple rules and be like, go and press them, right? Because we've all been there. We've all been in that situation where they do something you didn't want them to do, and you go, no, not yes! It happens like once a game, right? Right? Come on, right, everybody? Like once a game. But you have to be willing to let them do that, okay? If you put too many handcuffs on stuff and you make your offense too complicated, you got to be here at this time, you got to be there at this time, you got to be here at this time, you know, you got to make this read, you got to make this read, you got to make that read, they're just going to forget it, right? And you're going to get frustrated that they don't understand it. And you're not going to be successful. Now, the last caveat to all this stuff, okay? This is the offensive stuff I like to run, okay? If it doesn't work, I'll do something else, right? I'm not going to, like, hammer them in. You can't put the square peg in the round hole, right? If it's not going to work for us, the idea is to win the game. So if it's not working, do something else, right? Because you want to win the game, obviously. I mean, give yourself a quarter. Give yourself a half, right? I give it, like, a quarter, to be honest with you. If we're not getting what we want in the first quarter, we're making a couple adjustments, figuring out how they're playing us, well, then we're going to start doing some other stuff. Most likely, for me, we'll start inverting a lot more. That makes sense? Everybody with me so far? That's pretty much it, to be honest with you. Like I said, that's all we have in right now. That's all we needed this fall. You know, we put up some goals. We played against some good teams. I think everybody's happy with the results. Everything's trending in the right direction. So, again, keep it simple, stupid. Kiss method, number one. Questions? Anybody? Jokes? Nothing?
I'll ask one thing. You know, so much of, like, the motion offense, at least personally, is predicated on playing games with the two and then getting to the backside. And then when teams start going adjacent or going early adjacent, what are some of the reads you teach your guys? Because, you know, they get in the motion, they just put their head down, oh, I clear through. Wait, your guy's going. Especially, those are your college guys, high school guys,
that's
a dumb kid that was good school. You know, what are some of the things you teach them?
To be perfectly honest with you,
yeah.
If a team wants to fly adjacent, they're helping you out. In my opinion, they're helping you out, right? There's a couple teams in Division I who, like, slide almost all adjacent, and it's the best week of my life as an offensive coordinator. You know all the movement we have to do to play against crease slides and all that stuff? Believe it or not, you don't have to move when they start sliding adjacent. So if I'm going to play a team that wants to slide adjacent to pretty much everything, well, we're basically going to sit in the shape that's like a pinch 3-3 or that 2-1 or 2-3-1 from count from the back. If I've lost you, we'll draw it up so we know what we're talking about. But I would honestly, against teams that slide adjacent, play like this. Like a 3-high offense where we're still going to dodge the alleys. So think about this defensively with me. You got a D midi most likely. I put the LSM here in the middle and a D midi. Right? So, you always want to kick it down off this first adjacent slide. You got to dodge hard enough, and this is the stick work part that could be tougher for you at the high school level, right? You have to have good stick work in tight areas, and it's the type of idea where you got to be able to pass the ball right over the sliding defender's head, essentially, like Greg Paston. But if they're going to slide adjacent to this, get the blue one going. They're going to slide adjacent here and come across. Well, then I always want them to dump this down first, and then look diagonal past the guy that should be rotating down for them, right? So we're going to dump here and then look that way, if that makes sense. If this stuff, we're not getting what we need done out of that set, which most of the time, if you have the sticks to do it, you can. Another great option against adjacent stuff, and a lot of coaches, you'll see them do it. If we want to force someone to slide adjacent first, we'll get one of those big circle overload type things. And we'll give the whole side to one of our middies to dodge like straight towards the pipe so they have to slide adjacent from the next guy. Obviously, it's not a circle for very long. Most of the time, you're cutting into like some sort of a 2-2 right after that, which is what you want to do. If you can get in a big circle, make them slide adjacent, and then cut through that rotation, you start to find some stuff pretty easily. I call this, and this might confuse people, let's just call it motion adjacent pop, okay? It's a double pop, or motion double pop. But what we're going to do, we're going to get in that 1-3-2 set, okay? We're not going to rotate at all, though. So these attackmen are going to play way more goal line extended and more tight to the cage than normal, okay? But then otherwise, the set is exactly the same, right? Here's your dodger. We're assuming if they're sliding adjacent, this is the hot guy if I dodge the alley, right? All we do in this double pop situation is as he dodges, okay, this guy's going to fall down the backside, he's going to pop out top there, and he's going to front swing right to the middle, okay? Because this guy's defender who's standing in front of the cage needs to be the two over that attack, and after they slide adjacent off of him, more times than not, this guy's defender on the backside is going to have no idea what he's doing, he front swings through there. And if you do it right, he's wide open right off the bat. Okay? Sometimes you can throw it straight in from the mini to that guy. This guy's gone already. He's up here. Okay? When I draw it up, usually I teach it to him, I prefer him to kick it there and then look inside. Because it's just a better angle to feed it from. But it's worked for me. We've made it up kind of on the spot in a game once, and it worked great. Again, the idea just being, you're going to try to cut. They're going to rotate around the perimeter. That's what adjacent slides are, right? You want to, somewhere on the backside or behind the goal, cut through that rotation so that the next guy in the rotation doesn't stick with them, right? And if they do cut this, well, this guy would step back and kick it behind the cage, and this guy would probably be stepping down. I'd put a lefty there, probably, so that he could end up stepping down and catching the ball on the outside and, again, hopefully creating some sort of like a 10-yard step down. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Anybody else? Greeny?
In terms of, I guess, balancing player development while also trying to teach this, how much, I guess, do you even, like, incorporate, you know, the motion into your shooting drills, or do you do, like, smaller versions of this?
Absolutely. Right? We break out the midfielders in live drills. We'll do 3-on-3s with just the midfield triangle against the defense. We'll do 3-on-3s with just the attack triangle. In a situation where we'll tell them it's 3-on-3, but you can't set picks for each other at all. All you can do is rotate off each other. Okay, and the defense has to help then, too. And the reads become, you know, pretty simple. That's the kind of the concept. When we do that drill with the attack, and we're preaching Island X stuff. Okay, we want to get to the island, draw a slide, kick it to X, and then find the other guy. Okay, and that's basically the whole premise of the 2-2-2 offense. Island X, back and forth. We get to that in our motion, too. Once the attack touches the ball and they dodge, I always want the attack to dodge, draw a double, kick it back behind the goal, and go out the back side. Because that's when stuff gets pretty simple. Right? And then as far as shooting drills, absolutely. Any shooting drills you do, unless it's just for reps and volume of step downs, make your shooting drill also like a 3- or 4-man passing drill that's a part of your offense. Absolutely. Especially when you start talking about mumbos and coming off of mumbo screens to shoot the ball. Like, that can be a little awkward if you've never done it before, so it's a great thing to rep. All right, absolutely. Make your shooting drills from your offense. I joke with my guys all the time, kind of like, a little with myself, but on purpose. It's like, I just make it up as I go along, guys. Did you like that one? Good. You know? But that's, shooting drills should absolutely just come right from the offensive concept you're trying to work on. Totally. Anybody else?
You got it locked off.
You could force him adjacent.
Yeah,
you could use him as a pick. Right, you could use him as a double pick. Absolutely. For me, at our level, depending on who it is, are they going to shut him off with a pole? Like, do they want a sick player? Are they going to waste a pole to shut him off? If they are, and we're playing now against 3 poles and 2 shorties, I might just say, take the afternoon off, buddy. We'll play 5-on-5. I know it's a little tougher for you guys. He's probably your best player and the most capable one. But I would use him as in picks, absolutely.
movement picks and put him on the crease, make him slide adjacent. Teach him how he can hurt the backside rotation by getting it wet. I tell you, that's a big thing to do with man off shutoffs. Absolutely. Everybody else? Drills on drills on drills. That's what's next. Thanks for listening.
We have enough, but pretty much they're all kind of filling in, but just space these around. Maybe just like two or three a table, and then other guys can just look off.
Kenny, do you need your computer or not?
No.
Good?
Yep. So guys can see.
I have a cold, guys, so I'm not going to talk much. I'm just going to be a drawer.
Yeah. We're going to need. So we're going to do a lot of whiteboard here. Yeah, that's all right. All right, guys. So, you know, obviously doing a lot of these coaches clinics and going to a lot of these, you know, the one thing that I always get out of it is obviously a lot of drills. And I've been going to them for 15 years, and, you know, just like you guys are doing, I scribble some things down on a piece of paper, you know, and I have, honestly, stacks and stacks and stacks of paper of, you know, drills on drills on drills. So, tons of stuff. Today we're going to stick with pretty much numbers drills, which means pretty much odd man situations, 3v2, 4v3, 5v4. Not too much 6v5, I think one or two of them have that in there. But really, these type of drills, these number situations, is something that you should probably use within your practice, you know, at least once or twice a practice. It's a great starter. It's kind of hidden stick work a little bit. You know, also it's, you know, great for defense, sliding, communication, right? Great shooting and tight shooting sometimes. So just wanted to kind of take you through some of the ones throughout the years. You know, I had, like I said, I had stacks and stacks of them. I looked through some ones that I don't think, you know, everyone's seen. And, you know, maybe you get one or two out of it, and that's really great. You know, and that, I think that's the biggest point. Whenever I used to go to these clinics and conventions, and I went to all the U.S. lacrosse conventions and IMLCA conventions, you see all this stuff, and you can't do everything. And to be honest, you can't do too many drills in practice. You can't have too many drills. Right, the guys need to know what you're trying to accomplish in every drill. Right, what are we looking for here? What's the skill set that we're looking for? We're looking, you know, 3v2 numbers drill. You know, are we looking to draw and dunk? Are we looking to get reps? Right, there's a difference between running the drill quickly, right, and running the drill effectively. There's some drills where we'll just run and we won't do a lot of teaching, and we really just want to get the guys' sticks going, get them moving, get them flying around. And then there's some that will really slow down, and we're trying to develop, you know, specific, you know, 3v2 or 4v3, something like that. So first one, okay, scrapper drill, right? We're going to have, so basically you're just going to split up just a 3v2. It's a 1v1 GB into a 3v2, right? So you're going to have your lines like this. All right, pretty basic setup. This is a great drill to do, maybe for, you know, a lot of these are really good for pregame, but coach is going to be over here, right, with a bucket of balls, okay? These two guys are going to go on a one-on-one GB. So you're going to roll it out somewhere here in the corner, okay? Goalie's obviously in the net, right? These guys go on the one-on-one GB. If the offensive guy picks it up, okay, it releases these other guys. So then, sorry, I drew the X's. Usually the X's should be defense, okay? That was my first mistake of the night. But, So the X's are offense for this one. But so they'll step in, right? Steps in, and then they create that 3v2. The defensive guy picks it up. We always like, in a lot of these drills, obviously, you don't want to spend too much time clearing it all the way up. We just call it N1, right? Either throw it back through the goalie, okay, or have one of those guys break up the field. So it's just a great way to kind of get a scrappy GB. I think it's really important that you do some of these drills with a GB. Don't just, you know, see a lot of 3v2 drills and things like that where you're just throwing a guy a ball and getting it. I think that battle, especially at the younger ages, of ground balls is so important and
fundamentals. So just to build off that drill, you know, same thing here. We have these guys set up, you know, and let's do it right this time. All right. And then you can just add to this, okay? So you just add, you know, two lines down here, right? And now when these guys go for the GB, right, they release it, and now these guys are coming in, and everyone's breaking in, and it ends up a 5v4. So a lot of these drills, you could build, you know, different numbers. Really, I wouldn't go too big. You know, really, 6v5 in tight situations we stay away from, we could stop anything defensively 6v5, all right? There's not too much you're going to get out of it. Really, a lot of guys are just going to stand around, and you're not going to accomplish a lot. So those are the first two there. Next one, another good one for quick, you know, starting out, pregame drill, okay? You just get four lines, right? So you have your offense, right? Offense, defense. Coach is here with the bucket, right? Goalie's in the net. Whatever line you roll the ball to, that D guy doesn't come out. So if I roll the ball down here, right? This offense guy's going to pick it up. Now, you let these guys kind of cheat a little bit, the D guys, right? You kind of let them cheat in a little bit because they're not going to pick up the GB. But he's going to go after the GB, right? These guys are going to come in, slide across, right, fill in, and all the four offensive guys are in. So it's a nice 4v3 drill, but it starts with a GB. And, you know, a couple themes that I'm going to go over throughout the night. You know, we have a couple really basic rules about ground balls. Offensively, you pick up a ground ball on offense, you move it, all right? Pick it up, you move it. Defensively, you pick it up, you run to space. Those two things, as simple as it is, right, is, I think, lost a lot of times. Defensively especially, remember that, run to space. Don't run up the field, okay? I coach, you know, club team now and a lot of young guys, and every time they pick it up, they want to run through four or five guys getting up the field. It's okay to run back towards those pylons. So just another nice one, lots of reps. This is one of those ones that you get going really quick. Right, you're just rolling it out all different spots, and the guys are going pretty quick.
You learn pretty quickly when you throw it down to the low guys. You got to throw it offline a little bit on the roll so that they have to go get it. You threw it right at him, and he's not going.
It's a dunk.
Yeah.
So, you know, again, another good one there. Make sure I'm going in order here. Next one here. This is a little bit different. I think this is a great one for Coach Ford's offense and what you guys just learned. But this is a 3v3, and you could even leave off the on-ball picks, right, into a 4v3. I picked this up this summer. You know, we had a couple camps where, you know, we were working with some different guys and a couple different things, 3D. They have some, you know, set their picks and stuff like that. But basically you want to put set up your offense just with the midfielders in, right? So middies, that motion offense that Coach Ford just went over, they have it here, right? And you leave one attackman behind the cage. Then you put in your 3D, okay, so you got your D in here, right? And you play 3v3 up top. You don't let this guy sneak, okay? So you're playing this 3v3, right? He goes through the alley, right? Obviously, in Coach Ford's offense, this guy would go here. He would come outside, right? He throws back, and you kind of play that 3v3, you know, one or two passes. But then whenever a guy dodges down, right, you usually make him throw back the first time. On the second dodge, he can dodge down. And once he dodges down, he could throw behind the cage. If he throws behind the cage, it turns into a 4v3 drill. Okay, it kind of unlocks the guy behind, right? Which is great for the defense. Okay, so we just play 3v3, and we're getting used to our slide recovery up top, right? We're working that slide. We're coming off the crease. We're getting our fill in. Okay, they swing it. We bounce back out, and now this guy dodges down. Okay, they throw behind, and now we got to figure it out. And that happens a lot on defense, right? We get our slides going, we're moving all over the place, and now, you know, someone doesn't pick up behind the cage, and now this guy's going to probably press weak side. He goes, and now we're flying down the backside, and he just creates. So it turns a nice drill into a 3v3 where, you know, you're just playing your typical offense into something that's going to finish in a pretty positive result, okay? And you're going to get some more out of it than just going 3v3, ball goes on the ground. Nothing happens. Defense dominates as usual. Okay, this one obviously it ends and you get some more out of it. So one thing here with the picks, am I just erasing it quick? You know, the pick game on ball is becoming very popular, okay? And there's one, if you guys watch, Duke's very big into it with the pairs and kind of running a little bit of, you know, almost looks like a weave up top. So, you know, you can kind of run that into this weave here, right? If this guy starts with the ball, he's here, right? He's here. He starts coming on this, a little bit of a sweep here, right? This guy fades down. You could throw across, right? And then he goes and picks. This guy comes out, right? He comes off it. You want to throw early, so he throws early for the next one, right? This is that second pass. And then he goes and picks, right? And then he comes off it again. And you kind of just run that pick and weave, okay? And what that does is you have to work on your spacing a little bit, but that'll probably get the guy isolated over here, you know, for a nice, you know, one-on-one dodge in room. And really, that, if you can accomplish that, that's great. So you get that one-on-one dodge, and then again, you have that guy behind, so if you don't have anything going on, you know. So it's something else you can work on. Besides just that motion offense, you can work on a picks, pairs type offense as well. That's how I actually learned it over the summer. Box build up, all right? This is Coach Ford, Stroke Coach Ford. You got to come up for this one, all right? He brought this to us this year. You know, we were looking for a drill to kind of get the guys going. And a lot of these drills, like I talk about, should be your first drill in practice. And this is great. It gets the guys going every day.
This is like it's not my drill.
It's his drill. He made it up.
Nothing's mine. It's just an indoor drill, right? Like imagine you're in the rink, in the barn, as they call them. You're in the barn, and you've got the boards. Everybody just loops up, and you play odd man situations out. 2-on-1, 3-on-2, 4-on-3, add guys as well. So, yes, two lines of offense, right? Here's our lines. The D guys have the balls. Actually, sometimes left the goalies have them so that they're thrown out. That's right. I've got another bucket of balls up here for the coach. This is just in case the defense and the goalies, like most of the time, are competing this drill, too. They're throwing bad outlets on purpose. But the idea is simple rules. The goalies are going to throw outlets. I ask them to alternate which line. And all that's going to happen here is the O guys come up and loop. We work on maybe like a fake flip or a flip or maybe an early throw, especially as the ad guys are in. And then they come down and attack 2-on-1. That's how the drill starts. Okay? And again, this all indoor teams do this stuff. Right? It's just called build up out of the corner. When you're on an indoor team, you've got 10 righties and you've got 10 lefties. Perfect. Right? So the lefties are always in this line and the righties are always in this line so that you loop off and you end up on the correct side to stick up the field. Right? With us, the numbers obviously aren't nearly as even. They're getting more even for us. We're going to have a ton of lefties in the future. But there's a lot more righties than lefties. So everybody's going to play both hands here, rotate both sides. But the rules that we put in, both bow guys have to get outside the box. Okay? It's a sprint type drill. It's all out. Like, I'd rather you go hard and screw it up than lollygag and not really get anything out of it. But you got to force these guys to play it like it's boxed. It's called the box drill, right? So anybody that ends up on this side of the field should be right-handed if they stick up the field. Anybody that ends up on this side of the field should be left-handed if they stick up the field. Okay? The defense on the 2-on-1,
yeah, really.
It's really just jab stepping, maybe trying to pick a pass off.
It's a great diagram that.
As we build stuff up, it gets a little more complicated. But.
You know. 4v3, right? In a 4v3 situation, you want to pick up about 12 yards. Okay? That's about the good range to pick up. As we get less, so this is 4v3. In a 3v2 situation, it's about 9 yards, 8 yards here. Okay? And then a 2v1. It's like 6 or 7 yards, all right? And as, you know, as our numbers get lesser, we really want to get tighter to the cage, all right? So this is something that, you know, I looked at years ago, but it's really important that you don't just slide straight up and give up that dunk right away. We talk about, we always want to, they can throw more numbers, more passes than the guys we have out there, right? We win the drill. So if it's a 3v2 and they throw 3 passes, that's a win for the defense because it's not going to be 3v2 forever, right? If we finish with a check, that's great. Okay, we always want to finish with a check.
The only thing as it develops.
No, I'm just kidding. Go ahead.
Yeah, all we do when we start adding people in, if we do this for 6 minutes, we'll do like a minute of 2-on-1s, and then a bunch of 3-on-2s, and maybe at the end of it, we'll do some
4-on-3s. The 3-on-2s are where most of the good work gets done out of this. And all we do with the 3-on-2s, it works the exact same way, right? But whatever side the goalie or the defense threw the ball to, that line, two guys come out of that. Does that make sense? So the ball goes to your side, gets thrown to the lead man, another guy comes out from that side. So you get two. Go across, again, they may throw the first one early, then flip or fake flip the second one, but then they're attacking hard. The second guy in line should always be the middle guy, based on our rotation. Again, you have to get up outside the box, and you have to get to the opposite side you started on, which makes the second guy always the guy that should end up in the middle. We ran into some trouble with this as we were getting used to it. Guys that were a trail guy would just, like, get into the drill and then go right where they're comfortable. Like, no, no, no. Up and out of the box, to the backside, and no matter what, playing with the correct hand. Okay? Then when you add, obviously, another person into it defensively and offensively, you start working on a 4-on-3. The only thing, we haven't done much of that, to be honest with you, yet. We liked what we were getting out of the 3-on-2s, and it's kind of a bang-bang warm-up drill for stick work and offense, offensive numbers. When you do a lot of 4-on-3s out of this, it's a really neat opportunity, since it's a box lacrosse drill, to not just sit in a square offensively. The way I like to do it when we get to the 4-on-3 portion is set picks and use drags even though you have an extra guy, right? So what we would do, we clean this up a little bit and just start to show it. And this is O, 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 D, D, and we got D maybe here, hopefully, you know, inside 12 yards, picking up the ball, here's the ball. We would like to do the type of stuff where I either come and set one here and he drags off of it, or this guy can come down and pick, slip, and let this guy step off for the step down. Just non-traditional ways of playing 4-on-3s out by involving picks. Okay, use that extra guy to get in the way of the defensive rotation. That's part we haven't quite got to yet.
Or passing cut.
Passing cut, give and go. Just, yeah, absolutely. Kick it down and a cut from the top. Just anything you do to not let him stand in a box. You play the 4-on-3. Okay? Which I think could actually be pretty valuable at the high school level. Because if your defense, if you've got some good athletes on defense and your sticks aren't great, you're probably not going to score on as many 4-on-3s standing in a box as maybe a Division I team would. Right? Just because the stick work is going to break down before they knock something down. Right? So do it in a non-traditional way. Set a pick for the ball, let him come off it, then the defense has to react. Again, it's the concept of turning the 4-on-3 into the 3-on-2. And turning the 3-on-2 into the 4-on-3. As much as we can simplify that equation.
Great. Great drill. Next one I got, I thought this was great, really valuable. You know, we talk about 4v3s and continuing fast breaks. And, you know, the one thing that I can't stand about a lot of our fast break drills is that, you know, Joe stays here, Harry stays here, and Johnny stays right there. And they all just sit there, and the guy comes down, and they're all perfectly set up, right? They know what to do. They know where to slide, okay? And then we go into a game, and our first fast break, you know, and we're sliding out to 25 yards, and this guy's not there, and everything's messed up, all right? And that happens all the time, okay? And really, to stop a fast break, 90% of stopping it defensively is a perfect setup, all right? So, but in practice, you know, why would we want to give them a perfect setup every time, right? We want to communicate that and, you know, challenge our defense a little bit. So I found this one. It's called blind breaks, okay? The coach is going to be up here, right? And you have your midfield lines up there, okay? Then you got your D, all right? And we put the D like this, all right? Probably about like 15 yards out, right? And they're facing this way, okay? You get your attack, whether you're two up or, you know, whatever you are, two up, one up, whatever it is, okay? Now, they don't know, the defense, since they're facing that way, they don't know which way the coach is going to throw, all right? And he could vary it either side. And then also, we have these guys shuffle. So they got to kind of weave in and out of each other, you know, for a couple seconds. We don't get them too tired, but we have them weave in and out of each other, and then the coach blows the whistle, right, on the pass. So this guy's coming in, right, he throws the pass, now he's coming in, and now they got to communicate, I got point, I got left, I got right. You know, most of the time he's breaking down, he's breaking over, and they're getting into that L break, okay? But it's just something different, and it really challenges the defense a lot, right? You kind of create a, you know, different atmosphere for the guys than just sitting there being perfectly down, perfectly watching the play coming in. You know, so it's just some different variation of doing a fast break. So we found throughout the years, and I know a lot of guys say, you know, get up out of the box, right? And, you know, you do fast break drills for 5 minutes, and then all of a sudden the defense are attacked to stay down there. That happens on the college level as well, okay? They don't get out of the box every time. We scream at them all the time to get out of the box, but really, you know, it's hard. It's hard for a D guy to play full speed and then get back out of the box. So this is just something to do at half field and, you know, a nice variation.
I was just going to say, going along with what Coach said, when you're running full field transition drills, which we're not getting into really today, but when you are running them,
we have a couple.
A fair amount of the time, start your attack in D upfield where they would be in a game situation. The ball's down here, you guys are going to be, whether you're one up or two ball, you're going to be up in this setting. And that's what he was talking about. The ball's now coming back down. That's the way you run your breaks, right? The ball's coming, and everybody's got to drop into their spots. This is where the defense gets screwed up so often, because they have to drop in and figure it out from that point. So set up your transition drills with the guys already upfield.
And sacrifice.
As much as you possibly can.
Yeah, sacrifice time. Like, you know, you get into a lot of these drills, and you want to just go, go, go. And, you know, trust us, we'd go faster than anyone else. If you come to one of our practices, we're up and down. We're going 6-minute drills all the time. And it's hard to sacrifice time in there to teach. But, you know, spend the 5 seconds to make sure they get up out of the box, because it's valuable. Next one here, tight spaces. I think that's it, right? Yep, tight spaces. Yes. Okay. Tight spaces is a nice one here. So I don't know how you guys structure your practices and if you're valuable enough to have extra coaches. But something we spend a lot of time on is face-offs, okay? And, you know, so we, during the week, we'll spend a time where the face-off unit, not just the face-off guys are up there, but all the other players are up there and they're doing something. So the attacking D needs something to do, okay? So we kind of get into this a little bit where this is just a great drill for their hands, communication, defensive sticks, right? You have, how many guys play at on a women's field as well, okay? Right, if they have women's lines, that's great. It's perfect for this drill. If not, put some cones out. I think it's like a 15-meter it's called. And put your cage back. Usually our cage is like this. All right, put your cage back into their, you know, into their crease. And then it's just a 3v2, okay? You get three lines up top, right? Use tennis balls. Save your goalies a little bit. Coach Martin likes that. Okay, so these guys are stepping in. Two guys are stepping in, I formation. Coach is here, and he can throw it to one of the three guys, all right? But when I say this is one of those drills where you're going really, really quick, all right? These guys step in, and they have to stay inside this little boundary here that the girls' line drew up for us, which is great, all right? So it's really tight little passes. A couple things, you know, obviously, offensively, Coach Ford probably talked about a little bit, but, you know, you want to be more choked up on your stick, right? Just get it out of your stick quick. Again, we could force three passes, that's definitely a win for the defense. Most of the time, we're getting it in so quick, it's a pass and dunk. It's a great finishing drill, great for the goalies to finish. Defensively, okay, we actually split this one in half, so we don't necessarily just put all the D guys here, all the offensive guys up here. Generally, we split it dead in half, and we play for about 90 seconds, all right? Or actually, we played for a ball bucket, right? We filled one ball bucket perfectly, right? And with tennis balls. We played every tennis ball out, right? We keep track of the score, and then the other team switches it up and plays offense. Okay, so these guys start to get smart. They start cheating out and stuff like that. These guys are running in, ripping shots, okay? But it's just really good, especially with tennis balls, very valuable for your hands, right? You got to have soft hands to catch those tennis balls, getting it in and out. And these defense, right, playing that, just getting in the lanes, okay? If you get a knockdown, obviously in this drill, anytime the ball hits the ground, it's dead. Next tennis ball's coming in. So you just, you know, your sticks are all over the place trying to knock it down. Any questions on that? All right, this next one is going to take three markers. This one's a little complicated, but it's a fun drill, okay? It's called Normandy. And, you know, so we talk about sometimes you like to split up your practices and, you know, and make them competitive and not necessarily, you don't always have two teams. Sometimes you split them to three teams or something like that, right? And this is just a great drill to kind of, you know, split it into three ways and keep the guys going. It's a 4v3 drill, all right? And there's basically eight spots, all right? Four behind, right? four up top. And the way that this works, okay, is you're going to have your team in every spot. All right, so there's going to be three teams in every spot. So they're here. All right, I get the next one. You guys kind of get the idea. All right, and then we have red. Okay, I hate to use red, but you have to use it. Okay, and it's, let's just say that red's starting out here. Okay, they're in. You play the 4v3. And the best part about this drill is it gets 4v3s behind and up top for both teams, okay? But it's one of those last guy to touch leaves drill, right? So it's four guys, you play offense, defense, and then you go out, right? So these guys would step in, right? You roll the ball, you always want to roll the ball. So it's a GB, he picks it up, these four guys come in, right? 4v3, you know, say Frankie over here took the last shot, okay? He would step out, okay? And now, these three, black now is now in, all right? And then blue is coming in from behind. Or let's just say red's coming in from behind, because I just lost the marker, all right? And you go from there from behind. And it's just continuously going. 4v3 is up top, 4v3 is behind. And you just, you know, it's one of those drills, you just, you know, kind of fun at the end. Offense, defense, it doesn't really matter what you are, all right? Because you're going to play both offense, defense, and then out. Any question on that? It's a little confusing, but I think you guys get the gist, right? Another great one to keep score. All right, moving along here. Okay, this is a very good one for youth lacrosse.
Ken,
right? Yes?
On that one, why do you use three teams?
Just so you could kind of get it. Yeah, that was the way that it was taught, and I think it was just to kind of give one team a break. Just so the other teams are ready, you know, the next team's in and the next team's ready to go. But I'm sure you probably could do it with just two teams. The thing that's nice about that is not one team's not on offense behind all the time and one team's, you know, up top on offense. You really go, you switch on and off whether you're on top or behind on offense. So kind of get different situations there. This one here is GB in the box, the build up. All right, so you have, let's get rid of this one. Right, coach here, start out with an offensive guy there, right, O and D, right, coach rolls it out, so it's a 1v1 GB, these guys play it, again, just a lot of these drills, if a defender picks it up, right, just one more, so he would hit the goalie behind if he picks it up, if the offense picks it up, okay, he's going to come in on a 2-on-1. Now, we just build up from there, these two guys then just stay in, so now you got a guy, you know, guy here, right? Next two come in. Again, you roll it out, different spot. These two are going after it. 3v2. Okay? Those two stay in. Right? And then you go to the 4v3. All right? So just a nice way to kind of build up. Everyone's in one spot. All the lines are right here. All right? One good rule here, and I, you know, we're going to talk a little bit about 3v2 sides and things like that. And, you know, whenever a guy... We call this defensively when a guy scrapes, okay, which means I'm playing one guy and then I scrape over and play another guy, okay? So say up top here, let's just say they were like this. Say this guy was playing, he was playing right here, okay? And you throw the ball right there, okay? And this guy just scrapes over and plays him, right? Always throw back to where the scrape came from, all right? I can't tell you how many times when we do these drills, right, where the guy will throw here, and then they'll throw down, okay, to the guy who's covered, all right, and then have to make the extra pass to find the guy who's open. So it's just a common rule. Anytime a guy, you know, is playing someone else and he scrapes over, bounce it right back to that guy who you just got the pass from, okay, and you're going to get a better opportunity.
Mark asked a little while ago about how much skill development we do along with, you know, in our shooting drills and things like that. And this is a great example, too. When we talk about throwing back to the guy we just scraped off of, those are the kind of things you can do in shooting drills to really develop skills. He can't just throw it right back. You got to teach him to load up and draw the scrape to him, right? That's a skill that you have to teach. So we throw down to this guy scrapes off. The skill that this guy now has to have, other than recognizing that situation, is to load himself up, to draw that defender to him, and then snap it back. And that's a skill you have to practice. So every part of these, every part of the drills we do, every part of what we do in offense, translates to you finding skills that you need to teach to be able to execute. And these are the kind of drills where you can teach those skills.
Good. Any questions? All right, next one there, jailbreak GBs. Okay, and this is one that we use at Michigan. You know, like I said, you know, you're not going to be able to go back. You don't want to go back and use all these drills. You know, your guys aren't going to be able to remember them all and stuff. If you take one or two, it's great. This is one that we've been using at Michigan, you know, probably for 5 or 6 years now. All right, and it's developed a little bit here where, you know, what we found was with GB drills, okay, GBs on the crease defensively are really important, all right? And that key of picking up the ball and running to space is huge for us, okay? So basically our guys are lined up. Again, if you have that women's line there, that's great. You'll have some cones down here. All the other guys are lined up top so they can run in, all right? And this is one of those two ball drills, right? So the first ball, all right, I'm the coach inside here with a ball bucket or a couple balls on my stick, all right? I'm going to roll one out inside and get out of there, all right? I usually sprint out of there. Okay, sprint out, and now these guys are going after that GB. Everybody's coming in after that GB, right? It's in tight, right? You talk about the garbage goals, everything like that. But if our D guy picks it up, right, we have a couple things that we like to do. We don't like to throw it back to the goalie. We do not do that, all right? And if you coach lacrosse long enough, all right, you've given up one of those goals. And it only takes one for you never to throw back to the goalie again, okay? If we pick it up and we're right near the crease, right, we double hand stamp it, all right? Both hands down on the ground, okay? Not one, because the attacker will get underneath, but we pick it up, both hands down, okay? Until the goalie gets his stick over it, releases it, he picks it up and we're out, okay? Also, if we're around here, you know, if a D guy picks it up around here, we're getting out, right? We're just getting out. If an offensive guy in this drill, sometimes they get it, sometimes it's just a quick garbage, you know, pick it up, try to bury one quickly. Right now, the best part about this drill, the first one's very quick, right? If the D guy gets it, he gets it out, right? And now I'm outside here, right? Now I roll one usually up top or somewhere away with the second ball. Same group still in. Now these guys are going after it. Our rule defensively is we always want to challenge the next GB. So now it's a 4v3, right? We always let the offense get a beat on it, but now he's got to have that pressure GB with the guy behind him, something you see a lot for offense. Okay, so now he's a pressure GB, right? These guys start spoking out to their spots, right? Outlets. I think this is really overlooked as well, guys, right? To have, we call those hinges, or we used to call those hinges, all right? Is have guys as outlets on both sides of this guy as he's picking up the ball, because, like I said, the rule offensively, pick it up and move it, right? So this way he can pick it up, move it, and make that 4v3 into a 3v2, into a 2v1, and finish. Right, so a great drill, you know, we two GBs, we're getting after it hard, and then we release them, next seven guys come in, and we're good to go. Questions? Yeah.
I'm a little confused on the cadence from the first ball to the second ball.
Okay.
Like, so are you rolling that second ball out? Assuming the defense gets the first ball, are you rolling that ball out while that guy's on?
A little bit. Yeah, I mean, if he picks it up and he gets out, you know, usually I'm starting to roll it out then. And you'll find the timing as you do it. But it's actually good for that, because then it teaches them, you know, say they threw the ball away, sprint back in and get back into the hole and communicate that odd situation. I never roll it right to the offensive guy. Usually the offense, about 10 yards away, so he's getting kind of tracked down by somebody a little bit. And it's more of a challenge, GB. All right. This one's, you know, kind of a different drill, all right? I think, you know, this isn't as much numbers, all right? But we do a lot of 4v4 in our, you know, development of our offense and things like that. And this drill is great because a lot of our 4v4s and a lot of our, now we're starting to do this stuff, quick offense stuff with subbing, and guys are flying in. So this is 8+1+1. Basically, on every pass, we add a guy. So the offense is out here, right? And we let them play 4v4 a little bit and let them set up a dodge. So he'll come up, set up this first dodge. Okay, we have an offensive line up top here, right? And a defensive line usually out on the side, just right really near the box, out on the side there. So he comes down, he gets a dodge, right? He throws that first pass, right? And now this guy's stepping in. And this is great because he could, you know, throw there, cut through. This guy's stepping into that spot. And now it's a 5v4, okay? The next pass, the defenseman's stepping in. So it goes 5v4, right? Say he threw it down. This guy steps in. Say they swing it through X. Now the D guy's figuring in, coming in, and it's a 5v5, and he's got to figure it out, right? He's coming in. He doesn't know who he has, kind of like a recovery, right? So these guys on the backside are pointing to where that open guy is, okay? And then they drive the backside, right? And then on the next pass, we release another one and make it a 6v5. So it's just a great way to kind of make a really strange situation go on where, you know, you're even, right? A guy's coming in, defense has to communicate on the backside, right? They throw another pass. Now here's our D who just came back in. He's coming back in. He's got to figure out where the open guy is. And then you finish with a 6v5, which is, you know, kind of nice. Yep. Question?
When do you want the guy to use it from the top? Because it's like transition?
Kind of. It just kind of flows better, okay, to be honest. I mean, you could really put them, you could put them over here, you can put them behind, you can put them anywhere. I just found that it kind of flows better if you put them up top. Otherwise, it kind of fits more with, you know, with offense a little bit, right? Because if you're dodging from behind, you might want to put them behind. But if you're dodging from the top, this way he could come in and kind of fill that void a little bit. Good? Good. All right. What are we up to here? I got 20 drills in here. I don't know what number we're on, but we're moving here. We're moving. Next one here, okay, and we'll keep this pretty simple. All right, 3v2, okay, and how many guys here do 3v2 sides or have seen 3v2 sides? Okay, 3v2 sides is a great drill, and it's something, you know, it's something that teaches zone principles. There's some offensive principles in there. Defensively, it's great, you know, kind of the hedge, right? Does everyone know what I mean by hedge, covering two guys defensively, right? Playing between the two and buying time, right? Anytime that there's an odd man situation, we want to buy time. So 3v2 side drills is great. All right, this is one of those ones that's like the real, you know, speed it up, you know, get the guys going 3v2 side drill. So it's just an all angles drill, right? You're going to have them on every spot. Right? And there are just all four spots here, right on the box and behind. All right? So just to keep it simple, you know, you're just going, coach is rolling it in, and you always start with a ground ball. Rolling in. One thing that's important in this, okay, compete. All right, compete for the GB. Don't let your D guys just fall in. But, you know, you start out here, he rolls it, these guys are in, okay, they play it out, right, then you go from behind, then you go behind, all right, and then you go this side, then you go that side, all right. Offense, you know, this way they're not going against the same guys. Offense rotates one way, defense rotates the other way, all right, and it's just a way to, you know, keep the drill going, keep it going, and you're getting all different angles in there. Instead of, you could also do it, and we used to do this when we did it in seven lines, was you could go from each spot, all right, as the time goes on. You could start up top here, go for 2 minutes, right? Next 2 minutes, go from this spot. Next 2 minutes, go from this spot, you know, and then from there, all right? But just another variation of a 3v2 drill. All right, and this one's 3v2 sides, so just to mind just drawing up 3v2 sides real quick, Coach. All right, so now the D on this one, just say two D guys are in. All right, that's your traditional 3v2 sides. All right, and this one, all right, we're going to have the D guys kind of come in from, you know, through the top, just kind of come in two at a time. Because we're going to put an extra guy, right, and an extra D guy on this side, right? And the rule is we're going to wait, all right, until the first pass before we kind of bring them in, all right? And we kind of keep them out far enough. I should draw this a little further out. We keep them far enough out that they don't really disrupt. It's not a 4v3 right away. It's more of a 3v2, all right? And then they come in. And after, once they come in, right, obviously we don't play the side anymore, but he comes, draws a guy, right, and now they start. Here's the first pass, okay? And what's great about this is if this guy can buy time, now that this guy's released coming in, okay, if he could buy time down here with this hedge, he comes to the next pass, we have a third guy who could get to this pass down low. All right, and then obviously there's a guy in the backside who this guy has to help out and get down to. All right, so don't think of it as a 4v3 drill. It's your typical 3v2 size drill, right? But we're trying to create a timing with these guys coming in later, right? So it's not just, you know, 1, 2, 3 passes and finish. All right, it's kind of getting more of that side rotation for the defense. And it really teaches that, like I said, 3v2 size teaches that defense the hedge on that down low. And buy time for the next guy to come in. All right. Half field buildup. Right. This one's a great drill for the D. They love it at the end of practice because they get to shoot. This is what we used to call this, coach. So coach is up here. Right. We start with two defense in. Right. We throw it in here. Okay. These guys coming on 3-on-2. We used to call it landing drill, right? 3v2 here. After that, these two kind of break out, right, to these spots. They come on in and play defense, and now they're playing defense. The offensive guys that were just in are playing defense inside, so it's more like this, right? There's three of them in here, okay? There's the two D guys that were in, and then you add those two guys from down low, all right, in. Okay, so you go, you know, offense, defense, and then out. What's nice about this at the end of it, right, these guys who came in, right, these guys come out, these guys come off, and these guys then drop back in for the next 3v2. All right, you could actually build up to a 6v5 here if you want. All right, if once they get into a box, you could throw it back behind and go with two guys coming in and go 6v5. All right, but that's probably, you know, a little bit advanced. That just helps with a little bit of zone work as well. Everyone understand that one? We used to do that back in the day, last drill of practice. You know, you always want to end practice with a competitive, fun drill, you know, a scrimmage, something like that, something to get the guys going a little bit, right, so they don't just end on a stick work, especially early on, right? You don't want to just beat it into them, have some fun out there. So that was one of our drills for that. All right, this one we've been running in practice, very simple. Okay, you guys start drawing full field, coach. This is just 4v3 to 5v4, right? We'll have the attacking D in on each side. And basically, when we run these drills, we've been doing this one in practice a lot now. We've been working pretty heavily on our fast breaks and our slow breaks, right? We want to just get that ball out. First one's just a traditional fast break. You know, again, try to get the guys to start up. Right? I think we let the guys kind of start down the other day. But they're just going to come down one way, right on a 4v3.
Middies are in one line on one end and two lines on the other end.
Yep.
So you throw this one out. You got a 43 coming down this way. Set up as your 4-on-3. As soon as that's over, this guy is getting back into the hole, and you're breaking these two guys out. The goalie's throwing out to those two guys, and now you have a 54 coming down the other way. Or it might be a 4-on-3 if they beat this guy down the field.
Good.
Or a 4-on-4 situation. So it allows you to practice 4-on-3s, 4-on-4s, 5-on-4s, back and forth. Halfway through the drill, you just switch it, put two lines of blue, one line of black, switch the drill.
This next drill here, 4v3 continuous, all right, it's a great version. How many guys run West Jenny or 3v2 continuous? Okay, that's a great one. Obviously, all the guys, our guys still, to this day, love that. This is kind of different variation, and this goes back to the whole thing of, you know, not having your attack and D set up for a 4v3 drill. So here, you know, we bring it up to the restraining lines on each side, okay? And instead of having where you would have three lines, right, we just have one line of each, okay? We'll just say these guys here, all right, on the other side, right? And you have your attack and D in. These guys could actually be in the same color. Attack, attack, right, D, 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 right? He comes down, on a 4v3, okay, this guy would probably move over that side, 4v3 here, then the attack and D run to the other side, all right? So right away, here's the 4v3 coming down quick, goalie makes a save, whatever, they're hitting the breakout here, all six of these guys are sprinting down, right, this side, and setting up the fast break on the other side. Right, so then they take a shot on the other side, right? We let them do it one more time, right? So they end up going three fast breaks, okay? And it's just a really nice variation, and it doesn't let the attack and D get set, all right? And they're really, you know, they got to do all the running instead of the middies. The middies love it, all right? They just kind of catch the ball, run on down, and get into it. But it's a nice variation because, like we talk about all the time, that 4v3 is always, you know, set up. Yeah?
It's a 4-3, and then the same group goes down, they're 4-3, and then it kind of resets, is that what it is?
You just do it three times, yeah. We let them go three times. We found that three times. Okay. Is really the most they can do. Gotcha. You know, they're pretty spent after that, and then we just clear them out. You know, new six guys come in, and it keeps going. Next one here, what do we got? 54 chaser, correct? All right, a couple more here, finish off. About four more here to finish off real quick, okay? 54 chaser. All right, some people call this the last touch drill, right? Basically, it's the same setup that we had for our 5v4. You have it set up both ways, okay? So we have our attack and D in both sides, and we have our middies out on both sides. So our middies with the other team are out. All right, just picture the attack and D in, right? You start with one middie in here. Right, these guys are coming down. It's a 5v4. Again, you have, you know, attack and D. Okay, 5v4, right? The last guy to touch it has to go touch the top of the crease. So he would throw it here. He touches the top of the crease. This guy falls in, right? You throw to these outlets coming up the field, and you go 5v4 the other way. And it's the thing that's nice about this is you have that trailer coming in. So the 5v4 can't go forever. Right, and you just keep going. It goes continuously back and forth the whole time. The one thing in this drill, sometimes you'll recognize the goalies get quick outlets. You know, it might be a 4v3. So don't tell your guys not to assume the situation. Your attack should be calling out what the situation is each time. All right. Next one here. Okay, and I'll draw this up this way a little bit. Okay. This one here, all right, kind of got this. Again, it's so hard, besides scrimmaging, to duplicate weird situations that go on, right? And as coaches, we try to find ways to find these weird situations where broken clear, right? And these call this broken scramble drill here. But, you know, there's a lot of stuff that happens in the middle of the field, especially at your guys' level, where you just have to, you know, scramble and get in. So we have our attack and D in, you know, on both sides, right? Right, both sides are set up. Okay, we usually keep these guys more towards the restraining line here. But so now you have a mid, four mids in, and here's your coach. Okay, all the other mids can be out on the other side. Coach is going to roll it in here. He usually rolls it to one guy, right? And this is good for, this is a great GB drill as it is. You roll it to one guy, he's got to get double teamed. Okay, that's the rule. So he's got to pick it up and move it, right? So he picks it up, right? These guys double team him, moves it, and then it's the break, quick. And the one thing that we really keep these guys, we sometimes put cones out here where these guys aren't released, the attack and D are not released until that pass. Okay, so again, you're getting this weird situation in the middle of the field. That's not always this crystal clear fast break, right? This guy picks it up. He's all over here. He's there. He throws it. He lobs it. Something happens. And now it's a weird angle fast break. Something different is happening, okay? And then we just play out that fast break, and it's done, all right? It's a great GB drill, okay? That middle part there we do all the time for ground balls, right? You could even just do that box GBs, pick it up and move it a lot. Yeah, that's there. Again, pretty much same setup here, right, middle of the field, I'm going to stop drawing the attacking D. All right? But middle of the field here, we have our four. We have four mids out. Okay? And then you have your other middies lined up like they would be lined up for 54 chaser. Here's the coach. Okay? You're going to roll it out here. Here's a 2-on-2 GB, all right, which is another great situation that happens, okay? Whoever picks it up, right, let's just say, you know, the circles here pick it up, right? They come down this way, right? One of the other guys in the other team is just going to drop, okay? He's just going to drop back. So now, he would drop the other way, but now they come on a 5v4 this way, right? And we call this a quick outlet drill. So it's a 5v4, right? They shoot it, and then now these guys break the other way and come on a 5v4 that way. Because this one guy here dropped in the hole, right, to make it a 5v4 the other way. All right, so you pick it up, you let one, whoever doesn't get it, that one guy drops out. You go 5v4, right? They swing it out to the wing here. You're going 5v4 the other way, and then you start with the GB again. So it's kind of like a combination drill. You're getting a lot of ground balls. Right, that quick outlet, 5v4, getting the guys up and out is really important. Right, good for the goalies. Good work on the with the passes. This is the last drill. Okay. All right. Yeah, like perfect creases and everything. Take my time.
What is it?
Different colors. Bad sub drill. It's the. So we call this bad sub drill, all right? A lot of guys, you know, how many guys do a build up drill from the midfield where you go 4v3 and then another midi comes out, 4v4, 5v4, does anyone do that? Know that drill, right? This one is kind of the opposite, right? And obviously in, you know, college lacrosse, we want to get our own mids off the field sometimes, right? So now this is called a bad sub drill. The rule on this drill is it starts on a 6v5, right? You want to sub two guys from offense off every time. So if it starts on this one side, right, we just draw six guys in, all right, five D guys, right, so they shoot it, they say this guy shot it, or whatever, one of the guys shot it, right, these two guys got to sub off. You hit the outlet, this guy gets in, okay, the other guys stay in, it creates the 5v4 down the other side, right, and then they come down the other side, okay. They shoot it, both those guys got to leave. All right, remember, you got to sub two each time, and then it ends up a 4v3 the other way. So instead of building up, it's kind of a breakdown drill. Okay, so you're going 6v5, 5v4, 4v3, and you just kind of.
So this
keep
one guy will be going back and forth.
Yeah, that one guy stays in there for a little bit. All right, and it's really only three times up and down, but you get all three different situations. You can even start, it's a great way to start if you want to start man down. Start man down, let the two sub out, go 5v4, and then finish up 4v3. All right, so that was drills on drills on drills. So hopefully you guys got some good ones. Like I said, you know, it's you can't use them all, but like I learned, you know, through the years, you know, starting out with basic ground ball drills, things like that, you find little variations of drills that work for you guys, you know, and just little things that coaches do, you know, to make it that much better. All right, instead of just running a basic fast break drill, running it a little bit different, that really helps your program. Any questions? All right.
Thanks for being
here. Thanks, guys.